Hello, all you fabulous people. Kyle here, in case the country twang didn't give it away. I thought I'd pop in and give a little bit of context to this video, because it's going to be a side of me that you're not used to seeing. This video took place on April the 24th of 2018, on the Geek Room. And for weeks leading up to this, GMan had been repeatedly making homophobic and harassing videos aimed at a fellow Christian and friend of ours named Jade West. In the short time I had gotten to know Jade, I had developed a genuine respect and admiration for her vast knowledge, her quick wit, and her audacious spirit, especially in the face of the abuse she was receiving daily from GMan. And I just kind of got to a point where I was tired of it. I was tired of seeing the videos labeled, Jade West will burn in hell, Jade West needs to repent, day after day, all because she loved who she loved. And so I decided to enter a hangout. A hangout where GMan would be, True Empiricism, Antonio, Bionic Dance would be there, and Jade was there. But G-Man's ass was mine. It's kind of hard for me to watch this video. I didn't know it at the time, but this would be the last hangout that I would have with Jade. On June the 6th of 2018, Jade West passed away peacefully in her sleep, 1 week from her scheduled appearance on NonSequitur. This one's for you.
Sure.
And we are live. Jade, I sent it to you through Facebook. There you go. You got it. Never mind. Yeah, what's up, everyone? Frank here, Brand, with G-Man, Bionic Dance, Kyle. We have a new someone that joined us real quick that I think is a friend of Kyle's that kind of came up and wanted to be involved with this. We also have Jade. I think Antonio and True Imperialism is coming. I'm not exactly sure.
What a crew.
Yeah, are they coming, G-Man? Can you hear me?
His mic is still muted.
Yeah.
True has not gotten back with me yet. Okay. And I don't know about Antonio. Okay. But like I said, I'm fine being by myself. I'm not going to have a problem with this.
All right. So we are here to discuss G-Man's, one of his newest videos about sexual attraction and homosexuality. And I proposed this to Kyle. Kyle's like, let's set it up. And I got some other couple people to come in with us. Especially Jade, because I think someone had called Jade out, and such. So let's see how, which way we want to take this, who wants to go first, because it's not really exactly a debate, it's just more of a discussion, just kind of free flow. Let's try not to talk over each other, just so we can, keep it, you know, not as calamity. So, whoever wants to go first. Well, how about this? Since you're new, Brian, if it's okay to call you that, describe a little bit about you for me.
Sure. I don't know exactly what else to describe. I mean, I'm formerly a Christian, former young Earth creationist. I got interested in science because of my passion for the creationist views, and I was very passionately, anti-evolution in my thinking. And so I started to study science during undergraduate and quickly became no longer a creationist. And now I'm in grad school, currently working on my PhD in molecular biology. I'm also a member of the LGBT community. And so, of course, when I heard that there was a debate on the science of sexual attraction, it was something that was like, see if I can get in on this, because I'm something I'm not only personally interested in, but have a little bit of background in studying.
Excellent.
Yeah, excellent. So,
clear something up first before we start so that we're on all on equal ground. And that is to clear up that there is no difference, first of all, between same-sex attraction and homosexuality. It's the same thing. G-Man, I believe you had a video earlier saying that or it was entitled homosexuality versus same-sex attraction, and there is no difference there, so there's no point in having a versus there at all.
Did you watch the series of videos that was made?
I did. I think what you're doing is to think it's an attraction, and then the other is the actual act of having sex with somebody of the same sex, but there's no difference between the two.
No, that's not what I'm doing. When it's my turn to talk, I'll explain why.
Please clear it up.
I'll even explain why I even made the videos to begin with. But I'll let you guys go ahead and talk first, and then I'll gladly explain.
No, I think that's important. Why don't you tell us why you made the videos to begin with?
Okay. There's a YouTuber that's in this room right now named Jade, who loves to criticize me and talk about my Christianity and, you know, and talk about me on here all the time and whatnot. And I just decided one day to make a video and call her out on something that she said that she was a long time ago, and that she was a lesbian, that she only had interest in women. And I wanted to remind her what the Christian worldview was on this topic and to let her know that homosexuality is a sin according to the scripture. And after I did that, you know how it is here on YouTube. These atheists started making videos saying that, well, I'm not really a lesbian. I'm celibate, but I'm attracted to other women. You know what I mean? So I had to respond to all those different things. So it was like a lot of back and forth of me responding to different videos that they were making. But I'm very clear, crystal clear about where I stand on things.
Okay, Jade, do you want to, since he mentioned you there, do you want to comment?
Well, he hasn't yet once gotten my position right. And of course, he never bothered to ask me what it was, I guess. Apparently, just one day, he decided to attack me. And I don't talk about him all the time, but I do mention that I think he's a piss poor example of a Christian here on YouTube. And I'll be honest about that because of the way he lies about people. He makes up stories about people. He's angry. He's prideful. We all have our faults, but that's what I think. So I don't know why he suddenly decided to attack me, but there have been several videos mostly attacking me. And of course, other people have come forward to defend me. So yes, I'm a lesbian. Wow, big deal. I came out when I was in my 20s, which was back in the 1970s. So I've been gay for a long time. Now I'm celibate right now. There's no one in my life. I don't believe in casual sex. I don't critique anyone else for their lifestyle. What's right for them may not be right for me. I'm what's known as demisexual, which is a new term for some people. People who are demisexual tend to not have any sexual interest in someone until they've gotten to know them. So, you know, one of the things that G-Man seems to be confused about is the difference between attraction and lust. I guess he thinks they're the same thing, or he thinks that because you're gay, you're lusting at people all the time. I don't lust after anyone. Because, as I said, being demisexual, it's just not there. If I get to know someone, and my initial attraction to anyone is intellectual, as some people point out, the term sometimes used is sapiosexual. So my interest is someone that I can talk to, someone I'm interested in. So, you know, that would be my first interest in someone. And then if a romantic interest developed, that's when I might be interested in someone sexually. But G-Man doesn't seem to understand the different terms. He doesn't seem to understand that, yeah, same-sex attraction doesn't mean that you're out there screwing everything that moves. Yeah, being a homosexual and same-sex attraction are the same thing. Homosexuality is just that. It's just the attraction. If a homosexual is just simply someone who's attracted to a member of the same sex, that's it. Nothing more, nothing less. It's actually fairly simple. And as far as the Christian worldview, well, G-Man's particular and rather peculiar Christian worldview is actually in a very minority, because G-Man is a you know, extremely conservative, fundamentalist, evangelical type. There are other Christians in the world who don't even remotely agree with his positions on a lot of things, including homosexuality. As far as the Bible goes, the Old Testament doesn't really count as far as the laws in the Old Testament, because Christians are under the New Covenant. So it's perfectly okay to eat bacon wrapped shrimp, for example. In the Old Testament, that would be considered a double abomination, because it's bacon and shrimp. But just because something's called an abomination, well, you know, wearing mixed fabrics is an abomination. Having incorrect weights and measures is an abomination. There's a huge list of things that are abominations in the Old Testament. So who cares? And as far as the New Testament goes, Jesus never mentioned anything about homosexuality or same-sex attraction. The only references are in Paul, and two of them, no one knows what he meant by a word that he made up. And the other one is Romans, which is extremely problematic, because what is being talked about is the church at Rome that had gone back into doing pagan practices, including temple prostitution. And
say,
Go ahead.
On the point that you just brought up, when you're talking about the word that he made up, that word was
arsenikites. Yeah.
Which meant the arson part means man, and the kite part means bed. And what they're saying in context, based with the scripture, there's only two times that that word is used in the original Greek in the New Testament. There's only two times. So you can't look at the context on that, because they're both what everybody else or everybody nowadays is referring to, homosexuality. Right. But if you take that word and you put it against context in other Greek literature or writings, that term means loose man,
right?
Or a man who has many beds. So that could be interpreted as somebody who just sleeps around. So what they're doing is taking that original Greek word and making it into something that they want the narrative to be, which is completely false. And they're misreading the Bible. They don't even realize that they're misreading the Bible. So continue.
Yeah, you are exactly right. And it has been variously interpreted as being referring to pederasty, as you mentioned, to being a man who's just a dog sleeping around with everyone, or temple prostitution or prostitution in general. So we don't know what Paul meant by that term. And when he uses man in there, he's not referring to mankind. Let's make that clear. He's referring to the male of the species. There's a difference. You can't take an English word like man and suddenly say, well, that means mankind. You have to look at it in context of the actual Greek. So there's actually really almost nothing about homosexuality in the Bible. You can pull things out of it and try to make them fit, but it doesn't really work. And that the only hat that they have their hey the only I always say it backwards. The only thing they have to hang their hat on is Romans. And as I said, Romans is very problematic, because you have to read Romans all in one, and it is specifically, the entirety of Romans is specifically talking to the church at Rome that has gone back into using pagan practices, including things like temple prostitution and other activities. So I'm done. Nice cat, by the way, Bionic Dance.
Thanks. Her name's Columbia.
Hello, Columbia. Columbia, the gem of...
Could I actually add something to what Jade was talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, thanks. That was... I agree with pretty much everything that she said. I would just like to add real quick that even if 1 Corinthians 6, where it talks about arsenokoitis, does refer to homosexuality per se or homosexual sex, it doesn't necessarily remove homosexual sex from the historical and cultural context. I mean, Paul is writing as a first century individual to a church that was located in Greece, a pagan nation. And, you know, we have writings, for example, from other literature outside the New Testament from the first century. Like if you read Philo of Alexandria, his work is called The Special Laws, Book 3. He expresses, you know, he was a Jew who lived around the same time as Jesus, you know, so I mean, his views were representative of you know, Jewish intellectual thought in the first century. And he writes that you know, well, very condescending, you know, negative opinions about homosexuals and about effeminate men. But then he specifically attributes that attributes these phenomena that he's talking about to the worship of Demeter, who was a pagan, you know, Greco-Roman fertility goddess. And this is something that's echoed through the Old Testament and New Testament. I mean, in, you know, Leviticus chapter 18, for example, where it says, "Do not lie with a man as one lies with a woman." You know, if you back up to the beginning of the chapter, God is telling the Israelites, don't behave as they do in the land of Egypt or as they do in the land of Canaan. You know, there's no passage in the Old Testament or New Testament that talks about homosexual sex divorced from its ancient pagan connotations.
Well, let's let this immature idiot talk before he blows a gasket.
Oh, shit.
That would be you, idiot.
All right, who wants... G-Man, do you want to start?
No, I'm just, you know, listening to all of the scholarship that's in this room here today about what the Bible says and what it doesn't say. I just hope you guys actually read the book, because I'm just going to mute my mic.
The whole thing, cover to cover.
But, like, I want to learn, and I want to hear about how the Bible doesn't talk about homosexuality. So when I read the verses to you, you can tell me how that's not homosexuality and how it's not relevant to today. So I'm going to
read one.
No, I'm just going to mute, and I'm going to let you guys continue to do what you're doing.
Read one.
You said you have
verses that can point it out. Read one.
Okay, I'll read one right now. Hebrews chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. Because I know Jade was prepared for Romans 1, even though she's wrong on that one, too. It says, keeping on loving one another as brothers and sisters, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers. By doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure between a man and a woman. For God will judge the adulterer, and all the sexually immoral. Keep your lives free from the love of money, and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you and never will I forsake you. I'll go into what it means about sexually immoral a little bit later. Again, I want to listen to all your wonderful scholarship about what the Bible says about homosexuality. But as a matter of fact, and before I even stop, I do want to say one thing, go up something that Jay said. Jay said something along the lines that I don't understand her position. I have two channels that I talked about this stuff. One of them is my G-Man channel. The other one is Marked by God. If you go on Marked by God, I literally call her out, tell her, I'm actually telling her to admit that she's a lesbian and that to tell everybody whether or not it's sin, because according to the Old Testament, it's sin, and according to the New Testament, it is sin. Then I ask her to come out and tell everybody that she's not a lesbian, and in this room today, she already admitted it. So as far as I'm concerned, 70% of what I've been trying to get her to do has already been accomplished in this room, okay? But as far
anything that you ever say will be 70% correct. Why don't you give me a verse where the Bible talks about homosexuality? Because the last verse that you gave did not.
I just did.
Sexually immoral does not touch on. Have you had sex before marriage, G-Man?
Sexual immorality. That is not.
Have you had sex before marriage? Have you had sex before marriage?
Oh, yes, I have, yes.
Then you would be considered sexually immoral. So you're no different. Give me a verse where it's different.
Okay, first of all, do not put words in my mouth for what I'm saying. I'm not talking about fornication. I am talking about any sexual sin that will fall in the category of sexual immorality. And I would love to hear you say it.
You're putting yourself in the same boat. That's what I'm saying.
No, I'm
if
not.
If you've had sex prior to marriage, no, then not. That's sexually immoral, according to your book.
And then Jay got finished talking about the authority of Paul.
Let's go back to Jay. Let's not give me a verse that I'm trying to get. I want a verse where it backs up all this bullshit that you've been spouting.
All you're going to get is Hebrews today until I get ready to go somewhere further.
Oh, until you're ready. You know what that means? That you don't have another verse to go to.
Oh,
because
yes,
you know we're going to squash.
Oh, yes, I do.
Then give it to me. Why stall? Guys. That's what we're here for. Why stall?
Well, first of all, who am I talking to? And if you're just going to overtalk me, I'm going to mute and let you talk.
It doesn't matter who you're talking to.
No. If you want to talk, I'm going to mute.
Okay. Because, well, Antonio or True, you want to try to stand in here since he obviously... And this is why you can't listen to G-Man at all, because when he's brought in to confront the shit that he spouts when he's on one side of the computer, he can't back it up. So let me talk to somebody who thinks that they can back it up. Antonio, true? That's why, that's smart. There you go.
Well, I'm sorry. You guys, can you hear me? Okay, so back what up? Yeah, back what up?
Back up your claims of the homosexuality and stuff like that.
May I weigh in next real quick?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to make a quick point here. I mean, it's being said in here that
Antonio, I apologize. Mm-hmm. I just want to let everybody know that I never got a chance to make my full argument. Kyle, I don't know if it's called a filibuster or tried to overtalk me or whatever he wants to say. You never heard my full argument. And I got 6 videos on YouTube.
I'm not letting you spill your drivel. That's what I'm not doing. You can call it filibustering or whatever, but you made claims in your last videos, and I'm holding you accountable to those. And if you can't back those up, that's not my fucking problem.
Wow.
Wow.
I just wanted to make sure I know where you're coming from.
You're dealing with somebody now that's going to hold your feet to the fire. I'm not some pushover like you may be used to dealing with. But today, we're going to go to task on this homosexuality thing. And if it takes all night, I'm fine with that. I can stay up. I got no problem with it. But we're going to finish it tonight.
I'll let everybody know, if you type into the side chat, everybody can see it, since this is not like a regular.
No, I understand that. Okay. The palette is kind of fake right now, but
I'm just letting you know.
Like I said, I know what Kyle is doing. You know, when it's time for me to do it, Kyle, I don't want to hear you call me a hypocrite or nothing like that. Let me make sure we understand it, because you're acting very fake right now. You're being fake right now. Like, I can tell people how I met you, how I know anything about the NonSequitur, and the things that you promised to do, and I can talk about what you're doing right now. You can be nice. What,
that I was nice to you? I was actually looking to bring you on and involve you in the show.
But you're a comedian. You think you're funny and everything and whatnot, and I understand that. I never forgot those things.
About all that. So, I have nothing. Put it out there. Nothing to hide. Put it out there.
I can utterly destroy you later. It's not a problem.
What was I like to you, G-Man, before, except for nice? Did I not say that we should all get along?
Nice.
Of course I did.
He was doing everything else in the book. But the bottom line is, you're trying to take what I said in one verse and trying to argue that I never said anything else in my videos. Is that really the best you got? Dude, you're going to get destroyed today. I'm telling you that right now.
That's not actually what I said at all. I'm ready. Destroy me. I'm ready.
Are you gay?
Let's go.
Are you gay?
Are you gay now? Yes, of course.
You're gay. So I got bad news for you, Junior. Besides the fact that you're an atheist, you're going to the lake of fire. You're going to the lake of fire for sinning against God for being gay. And trust me, I can let go too. And I'm a lot more than you.
Fuck your Bible and your God. I don't believe in either one of them. And I will not be burning in the lake of fire. That's what I can tell you right now.
That said that you don't believe in the Bible, but you want to claim you're a scholar of the Bible. A book you never read.
I used to be one. I used to be one for 25 years. I broke that book way better than you can. I promise you that.
No, you
want to try that? I'm ready. I've got my notes right here, buddy. Every single one of them.
Let's go with the verses.
Come on. Let's fight. Let's fight Bible with Bible. I'm ready.
Well, I just want
I've got every verse. The Bible deals with homosexuality and its context.
What you got to say, Antonio? Let's let Antonio in. He's been trying to say something.
Kyle, I mentioned sexual immorality.
And get back to the topic.
Kyle, I mentioned sexual immorality. You did not definitively prove, especially as supposed to be some type of smart atheist, how sexual immorality does not deal with the topics of fornication, bestiality, homosexuality, or any other sexual sin.
I asked you something first, where it deals with it. You gave that as an example of where it dealt with homosexuality. And what I'm telling you is that verse also deals with you. It's sex before marriage. That's so therefore,
that's actually immoral too. I became a Christian. Pay attention, Kyle, because you're about to learn something now, okay? Okay, pay attention, Kyle, because you don't know the Bible, okay?
I just said I'm ready.
before I became a Christian, I was a sinner.
Right.
Okay? Right. After I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior, I'm a redeemed sinner. Of course, you don't know nothing about that. Okay?
So before be saved, I became a Christian, go do whatever the hell you want to, right?
You don't want to have a conversation. You want to have an over-talking show. You keep that up, dude. You're going to be talking to yourself soon. I'm telling you that right now.
I doubt
so you can make happens. Your mind. We can have a back and forth, or I can put you on my condition list, too. I don't got a problem with that. Okay?
Fuck your condition list. Okay, I'm not worried about being on
your condition. I am not talking to you no more because you're an idiot, and you don't know nothing about this topic.
That's what I thought.
You can't no, that's what right. You put words right. In my mouth.
I mean, I still never got to make my point at all, but all right.
For the record, I just want to say that Kyle says, not me, that sexual immorality is dealing with fornication, and because I'm a fornicator, is dealing with me. That is the best this guy has. Sit down, Kyle, man. Come on.
No, it's not. No, I'm just going
to make a guess on your show. You're horrible.
The best I've got, man. Bring your best. I'll show you mine.
All right, let's let Antonio get his get him what he wants to say out.
I think Kate has wanted to say something for a while.
Yeah, well, what I want to ask, number one, speaking as a lesbian, if homosexuality is sin, it's wonderful, lovely, delicious sin. But that said, I've never actually heard a good reason why God, if such a creature exists, would consider homosexuality such a horrible thing. Who does it hurt? I've never heard a good answer for that. All the closest I've ever heard is someone going, well, sex should be for children. That's all I've ever heard. And okay, well, suppose we all tried to breed and had some homosexual sex on the side. Why is that so horrible? I really want a good answer to that.
Well, let's entertain that for a little bit.
Just real quick. Should we refer to as Bionic Dance Kate? Which one do you prefer?
Either way, I had some people in a hangout the other night call me BD. I don't care, just as long as it's not you, asshole.
You don't have that issue from me, by the way. So good to speak to you for the first time. I've been watching your videos on and off for years, and I'm glad to speak with you for the first time. We actually had a brief exchange a while back, you know, about two or three videos or so. But anyway, I just got to expand on a little something that G-Man said. The point's been brought up that, well, homosexuality is not mentioned in the Bible. Well, you know what? Neither is things like pedophilia. But that's just an argument from silence. I mean, we're not going to sit up here and say, why? Because the Bible doesn't mention pedophilia.
Are you going to equate the two?
Well, the point is simple. The lack of something being mentioned is not a permitting of something necessarily. So you can't say that it's a necessary permission in the Bible, that just because it may not have some sort of explicit mention that the Bible somehow condones it, because that would be like saying that the Bible doesn't mention pedophilia, therefore it's okay for adults to have sex with 5-year-olds. You can't use the lack of the mention. It's an argument from silence that you made. I was just pointing out the fallacy in your thinking.
That argument goes the other way too, though, because I mean, the Bible also doesn't mention, you know, democratic government. I mean, there's the fact that it's silent on the topic doesn't mean that that it's, you know, wrong to engage in it. You know, it goes either way, or I should say, it's a double edged sword.
I agree.
Right, it could.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jade.
I was just going to say there's a difference between condemning and condoning. Because something isn't mentioned in the Bible does not mean that it is condoned. But because something isn't mentioned in the Bible, it also doesn't mean it's condemned. So you can't say something is condemned according to the Bible if it's not there. I'm currently eating taquitos, and they aren't condoned in the Bible, but they aren't condemned. Yes, there are lots of things. Internet fraud is not condemned in the Bible, and yet most of us would consider it wrong. So there's a difference between condoning and condemning. I don't think anyone's making the argument that because it isn't condemned in the Bible, it's condoned. We're just simply saying it's not condemned.
Well, I guess it'll be helpful to define what I mean by condone. What I mean by condone is that God will specifically look at this, whatever act in question, and say it doesn't violate his moral nature. And I don't think you can say that people committing acts of homosexuality or gayness or whatever you want to call it, that would not offend God's moral nature.
Hold on, guys. Let's step back for a little bit. Are we saying that homosexuality isn't in the Bible? Like, it's not condemned? What exactly is the critique here?
Correct. That it's not condemned.
Yeah, nobody was threatened. Nobody got the death penalty in the Old Testament for being gay. Oh, yeah, you're definitely. We can't go to look at it.
Just because we were dicks. Down with mankind,
like womankind, right? It doesn't say that, right?
Right.
Right. Bionic Dance, let me ask you something about Bionic Dance. On your channel, do you have a video on your channel, Bionic Dance, with God talking about we have a channel, we have a video in there talking about how God tells the children of Israel to kill homosexuals in the Old Testament? And does the Atheist Experience have a video on their channel where they say that homosexuals are killed in the Bible, according to the Bible?
I can't speak for the Atheist Experience. They would have to check that. The video you described on my channel, I don't recall, but I have more than 1,400 of them spanning over 10 years, so I couldn't tell you. If the Bible says something about children condemning homosexuals, that doesn't sound right to me.
I didn't say children condemning homosexuals.
Sounded like it.
Killing of homosexuals.
Okay, killing, condemning, big, fat, hairy deal. I don't remember anything about children having to kill homosexuals. If it's in there, I've only gotten about halfway through Second Kings, okay? So I don't know.
You haven't read the Bible, right?
Well, I'm working on it.
Yeah, Kyle hasn't read it either, so don't feel bad either. Neither has this other
bookmark. Okay, I'm working on it.
Don't speak for me, dipshit. I can speak for myself.
Yeah, you really can't say that someone hasn't read the Bible if you really don't know.
Kyle, is it one of the Old Testament laws, Kyle? When homosexuals are killed in the Old Testament, yes or no? You said it's not in the Bible, first of all, so I'm going to correct you on that verse.
I don't think.
Read me the verse.
No, I don't need to read the verse because Kyle says it's not in the Bible, and so does the rest of the verse. Does it say it, yes or no? Answer my question.
I don't know. Read me the verse.
You don't know. So you haven't read the Bible. You're having a conversation with me, and you're trying to tell Christians.
G-Man, learn sarcasm.
What it doesn't say.
Why won't you read the verse?
Because I don't have it in front of me.
Leviticus talks about if a man lies with a man, then he should be put to death. I mean,
according to you, homosexuality is not mentioned in the Bible, but in the Old Testament it is there.
I'll wait.
So, Kyle, why don't you do me a favor? I'm going to mute my microphone, and why don't you what do you guys call it, double down or back up or retract your statement and tell everybody homosexuality is condemned in the Bible?
You want me to show you where it is condemned? It's not the here's what I'm trying to explain to you. It's not the act of homosexuality that is condemned. Back in the Old Testament, there were a set of laws that Israel had to live by in order to please God, because the neighboring tribes were involved in pagan worship. There was a law where they couldn't cut the sides of their hair. The sides of their hair had to continue to be grow out. You couldn't cut the side of your hair. That was a law to separate them from the tribes that neighbored them. Now, one of those things that they used to do in their pagan worship, sexuality used to be tied to that. One of the things that they had were these prostitutes at the temple. Now, a offering to those prostitutes and they were boy prostitutes, by the way, just to throw that out there. The men would have sex with these boy prostitutes as a sacrifice to their pagan gods or whatever. God is listing out a list of things that you should not do, and the punishment for that, if you do, then you're not differentiating yourself between those neighboring tribes. It's a contextual thing. He didn't come out and say
the Bible where it says any of that garbage. Where is this thing at in the Bible?
Hold on, let him finish. You wanted him to do it. Just let him finish, okay?
One second. No, he can go ahead. I'll give him the verses here. Let me find them.
While we're at it, I am still waiting for an answer to my question.
Which question is that again?
The first thing we got to do before we go anywhere is the fact that they said that homosexuality is not mentioned in the Bible, and I know that's a lie straight out of hell. So I want to know why he didn't reference the Old Testament, because I can tie the Old Testament with the New Testament. That's not difficult. I just didn't hang out yesterday on the Apostle Paul and what he taught and his authority of his word and why his word was actually scripture. And I can give you those verses if you will like them. But before we do that, I want you to acknowledge the Old Testament law where if a man lied down with another man in the Old Testament, he was stoned to death. Okay, so say I would like to know how you're gonna sit there and say that it's not in the Bible. That it is in the Bible.
I think it's pretty clear. I think most of us, I mean, I don't want to speak for everybody, but I'm pretty sure that most of us are aware of the fact that in the Old Testament, the Bible condemned homosexuality, that you would be put to death.
That's not what they said, though, Drew. What they tried to say earlier was this. They said that homosexuality is not in the Bible. That's what they said in here. You understand what I'm saying? So what I'm trying to do before we can even have an intelligent conversation with a bunch of people who haven't read the Bible yet is to first establish
the Bible.
You don't even know what the book says about it. So my thing is this. If it talks about it in Leviticus, about the stoning of people, where you had a man lying down with another man, and that evil had to be purged away from the land according to the law, I want, and by the way, don't you ever go to them Hebrew Israelites outside and say something like that. You will get utterly humiliated, all right? The bottom line is, please show me if in the Old Testament, how it's not being condemned. I mean, I can take you to Sodom and Gomorrah. I can take you to a bunch of different things. I can take you to Noah's flood. I can take you to a lot of things. But before you go to
Sodom and Gomorrah,
tell me about the law.
You know the story behind Sodom and Gomorrah. You sure you want to go to Sodom and Gomorrah?
Let's go to Sodom and Gomorrah. You can't tell me about Sodom and Gomorrah.
Just real quick, guys.
Tell me how Sodom and Gomorrah is related. Let's go.
We'll just real quick, guys. I don't want to get away from Kate's question. What was your question again, Kate?
It was what God actually has against homosexuality. I mean, why is it a problem?
Well, I mean, I think it's the same thing he would have against pedophilia. It's the same thing he would have against bestiality.
Pedophilia and bestiality are not consensual. One could easily say that pedophilia is harmful. So... But homosexuality tends to be consensual, and the people engaging in it tend to have a certain amount of a good time. I don't think those are good equivalents.
Well, here's the thing, Kate. You bring up the idea about consent. Well, you know what else is not consensual? Humans eating animals. Is that a problem too?
Right, and I would say this, that
why does it comply? I'm sorry, Drew, go ahead.
I don't want to overtalk. I know I keep on overtalking you, Antonio. Go ahead.
No. I'm good. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to try to entertain the idea of conceptual. If we put away what the scripture says for a second, because I think we all agree that the scripture does condemn what the Bible says. We can take into consideration what it says in the New Testament when the woman was caught in the very act of adultery and Jesus lunged over and wrote in the ground and said, "He who be without sin, let him cast the first stone." There's a different approach that Christians take. We got to understand that we're not talking to Jews right now. We're talking to Christians. But I would like to entertain it from a rational standpoint that it seems like Kate is trying to approach it from what is wrong with it. And she brought up this issue of it being due to the issue of consent. And I think you started touching on it, Antonio. But I think the issue is with homosexuality, if we're going to use an argument for consent, that opens the door for a lot of other issues. Now, what about something like incest, something that is between a daughter and a father or a brother and a sister, full-grown adult? What would you guys say to something like that? Consent.
We would say it's disgusting and not compare the two. That's the most emotional comparison I've ever heard in my life. You're a fucking
dope.
That's
an emotional argument.
Well, part of my argument was about harm. Now, if nothing else, a father and a daughter, incest of any kind, generally tends to produce a certain amount of genetic abnormality in any offspring. So right away, we can say it could cause a kind of harm that homosexuality never could.
What if you have a mother and a son or something that's practicing protection? Does it become acceptable now?
It's
mentally harmful.
It's dicey.
Yes, mentally.
You think? Wait a minute. So I guess what it does at this point is that it turns into a discussion on like where we draw the line. I mean, you could say that killing animals and eating them for consumption purposes, killing animals, they harm them too. So,
even so, I mean, when it comes right down to it, we could argue all day about whether other things are harmful or not. But my question was about homosexuality, because everyone involved is having a good time. It's consensual. See. It's not harmful. So why is that specifically homosexuality a bad thing?
I think the reason why we're bringing this up is because if we're going to be logically consistent with our standards for homosexuality, other things that would follow the same standards, we would also at the same time not agree with. Well, so this is the problem. Even if you throw away the Bible, what I'm trying to say here is, even if you just don't look at what the Bible says, I think it's very difficult for anybody to rationalize or logically defend this position.
Okay, but the thing I'm asking, though, is not so much what we think. Why is God so bent out of shape about it? What's God's reason for saying it's horrible?
Well, Kate, I'm going to give you a straight answer to that. And I'll be honest and say, I don't know.
Thank you. That is the first honest answer I have ever had to that question.
No, but you know what? I also don't know why he didn't reveal to us when he's going to come back exactly. I also don't know why there are certain things in Scripture that seem to not be so clear-cut, and we debate on these things like Calvinism and Arminianism and other sorts of things like this. I also don't know about a lot of that stuff, but that doesn't mean that because me not knowing this, if I'm going to be a consistent following Christian, I'm going to look at the things in which I do know and follow what he says. I do hope that at some point, you know, maybe he would make those things more, and you know, at some point he will make those things clear to us, because if we assume that Christian theology is true, Jesus comes back and everything, he's going to make all that stuff clear. But in the meantime, I just follow what he says. And just because I don't know certain things doesn't mean that it's an argument against his nature. I mean, ultimately, whatever is outside of his nature, according to Christian theology, whatever contradicts his nature is sinful. Whether I have these hardcore no answers or not.
Well, I mean, then we could get into a lot of is God even real stuff, but I figure that's way too far off topic.
Sure. But I'll tell you one thing. It would seem I probably wouldn't like make such a big issue against it if I wasn't a Christian. But I mean, I think, like you truly was pointing out, even from a rational perspective, it's hard to see how you can, you know, continue the population of the human species. I mean, if you just threw a bunch of homosexual gay people on a planet, they'd be all gone, you know, in a generation or two.
No, that's wrong.
Yeah, that's not exactly right.
Even if that wasn't wrong, what's the what's the word I'm looking for? Proportion of gay to straight, because it's not like you'd have a bunch of homosexuals who are like supplanting all of the people who are breeding. I mean, that's just ridiculous. Plus, I have plenty of lesbian friends who've done implantation, artificial insemination. So again, you can still have a human race. That's just not an argument that I think holds the least bit of weight right there.
So you have to bring in a third party, basically, is what you're getting at. And
That's not what I'm getting at. I'm saying that's a possibility. I'm saying that's one of the things you can do. Well, the main gist of my argument is that the percentage of gay to straight is so low that it's not even worth considering that homosexuality homosexuals are going to make the human population die out. That's just ludicrous.
I think that's a great point to touch on. But let's say, just as a thought of experiment, we shift the percent from, would you say it's more 1%, less than 1%? What would you say the percent is if you were to give your best estimate?
Well, I'd have to look that up, but it's pretty low.
Mm-hmm. 10%.
It's at least 10%.
Oh, okay. Let's go with that. Let's say, just hypothetically speaking, we shift the percent to, let's just flip it around entirely, just to 10% straight, 90% homosexual. Would, you know, it then become a problem?
No, it would not become a problem. And I'll tell you why it wouldn't become a problem. Because the urge to parent exists in homosexuals as well as heterosexuals. And homosexuals would still have children. Back in my day, when I was, you know, much younger, people still manage to have children, sometimes using a turkey baster, sometimes the old-fashioned way. I understand alcohol helps. It was a decision between the people to have children. So no, it wouldn't stop. And if you look at right now, gays are, especially gay couples, are adopting children all the time. They're adopting the children that straights are throwing away. So the urge to parent isn't going to exist, you know, isn't going to stop existing if the population is largely gay. And the number of children, well, it might be fewer because there's going to be less accidents, but no, it wouldn't.
But the being from a rational standpoint, the only way, you know, outside of adoption, the only way to facilitate any sort of relationship in which gay parents will have children is to bring in a third party source. Like with two men, you'll have to bring in a woman to act as a surrogate, or with two women, you'll have to have them go to a sperm bank and then, you know, implant sperm inside of herself. And you got this third party element that's necessary for them to have children at all. You know,
what's wrong with that?
It just seems to push the confines, and I don't want to, you know, fall into some naturalistic fallacy, but it does push the confines of just the natural way things work. You know what I mean?
Well, suppose wait a minute. Suppose it's way in the future, or even just a decade or two in the future, and we have some sort of like artificial wombs or cloning vats. Does that solve your problem?
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jay. Was you about to speak?
But what I was going to say is there are a lot of heterosexual couples who have to use a sperm bank because infertility is an increasing problem in this country for various reasons. It is apparently an increasing problem in the world. Bring in a third party, so what? And I said, back in the day, you didn't need a sperm bank. All you needed was an agreeable friend with some literature to get him excited, and a turkey baster, and a woman could get pregnant that way.
Jay, let's ask the guy who's going through. He's getting his master's in biology.
Yeah.
If it's an abomination and all that bullshit, why do we not just see it in humans? Why also do animals exhibit homosexuality?
Well, you know, there are animals who eat their own young too, but that doesn't mean that humans should do it, although maybe in some indigenous cultures that happens.
That's not my point. My point is that everybody says it's unnatural. I'm asking, natural, why does it exist in nature?
I think there are some things which...
Next question.
I think there are some things which we would accept that are natural, and things that we would accept that are natural that we wouldn't, you know, permit, and as a sort of moral framework. Like I think it's been studies done that even pedophilic attractions, you know, seem to be natural, but
for fuck's sake,
that doesn't mean no. Have you okay?
Yeah,
fine.
It's bullshit. Biology, Brian, can you explain because I'm not gonna sit here and listen to somebody compare homosexuality to pedophilia. You're a fucking dope, and you just shut up.
If you're just gonna call me names and just yell yes, that's fine. If we can't have a conversation like adults.
Brian.
Yeah, what's up?
We're waiting on some biology, not this.
Yeah, show us some biology. Show us the science on how homosexuality is beneficial to society.
You know what? If this is what the conversation
is beneficial to society, studies show that people who are homosexual have higher intelligence.
If this is what the conversation is going to devolve to, I'll just exit myself from the conversation.
You want me to pull those up for you?
Yeah, can I just add something real quick?
If this is what the conversation is going to devolve to, I'll just exit myself from it. You know?
Then you should exit because you divulged the conversation when you compared pedophilia to homosexuality. So if you'd like to exit, be my fucking guest, Brian.
Well, you won't have to worry about that because, number one, I'm on a library computer anyway, so I'm on a timer. But even if I wasn't, I'd probably still leave anyway. So you won't have to worry about
that.
There ain't no anchor tied to your ass.
Yeah, so there was some conversation going on a couple minutes ago that had to do with, why would homosexuality exist in the population? I'm paraphrasing, of course. you know, if it doesn't have any sort of benefit for society. And I think, Antonio, you made some comments about, you know, like homosexuals don't really contribute to population growth, you know, the whole be fruitful and multiply thing. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I'm trying to, you know, paraphrase, you know, like in 20 seconds, you know, 5 minutes worth of conversation. In any case, you know, a lot of that conversation is contingent on the assumption that the factors contributing to homosexuality don't have any sort of benefit to the gene pool. And that's actually an unjustified assumption. I mean, you know, the factors that contribute to the, you know, let's back out from homosexuality specifically and just talk about androphilia, attraction to males. And, you know, you can postulate, you know, similar analogous factors for, you know, gynophilia, attraction to females, but let's just take androphilia, attraction to males. You know, if there's genetic factors that contribute to the phenomenon of androphilia, then a female who inherits those genetic factors is going to be more likely to grow up to be attracted to males or have a, you know, a stronger attraction to males than she would otherwise have. And that's going to lead to, you know, increased propensity towards reproductive behavior. If a male, however, inherits these exact same genetic factors, he's also going to grow up with a propensity towards androphilia, which is going to promote homosexuality or bisexuality. And, you know, this is it's a hypothesis, but it's a hypothesis that's been, you know, borne out by the data. For example, there's a paper I'm looking at right now, the Public Library of Science Journal PLOS One published a paper December of 2012, fecundity of paternal and maternal non-parental female relatives of homosexual and heterosexual men. Basically, what they found is that the female maternal relatives of homosexual males, on average, have higher rates of fecundity, higher rates of reproductive activity than other females in the rest of the general population. So even though male homosexuals are less likely to reproduce intrinsically, their genes are shared by female relatives who are more likely to reproduce, and that this offsets the lower reproductive rates among homosexual males. So on a population, you got to remember, it's not individual people that evolve, it's populations that evolve. So on a population-wide scale, the genetic factors that contribute to homosexuality appear to also contribute in other less direct ways to reproductive success of the population.
Yeah, and your proof of any of that is, because the last time I checked, LGBT people die faster than those of who are heterosexual.
How did they die?
Depression. No one will accept them in society, you know.
Prove it.
Oh, I can prove it. I'll do it on GTV.
Show me.
Why can't you do it now?
I'll show you the same amount of
proof. Bitch made, G-Man. That's why you're fucking bitch made. I asked for proof.
This guy just made a bunch of money.
Come on. Bring your proof if they die sooner. You don't have it. You're a fucking joke. I don't know if anybody takes you seriously.
Butt hurt, Kyle, because society don't want to Kyle.
Hold on.
Society has accepted me like crazy. What I don't like is some fucking dope getting on here spouting off and picking on Jade. It's not because you're picking on me. It's because you went after Jade. You went after somebody that's not bothering anybody. It's being a good Christian. She's twice the Christian you'll ever be, you fucking joke.
You don't know what a Christian is, Kyle. You can't be a Christian and be homosexual at the same time.
Nobody takes you seriously, dude. You're a fucking joke.
Homosexual at the same time.
Remember that. But if you want to come at me with scripture, I'll whip your ass from one end of this hangout to the other with scripture, too.
Repent and come to Jesus Christ. Why you
bitch made?
All right, hold on. G-Man, what is your
proof?
Yeah, let's calm down. G-Man,
folks,
what is your proof?
Let's calm down. Let's also try to be adults, G-Man.
Look, I do want to see your proof that homosexuals die faster. Where is your proof?
Don't worry.
We don't have any.
Flower video. If I may.
Go ahead.
He's a lying cunt.
Anal cancer, I can show you a bunch of things, but I don't have all that stuff in front of me. So that's what I was trying to prove to Jade, that she was not a Christian because she was a homosexual. Because homosexuals are condemned to scripture. Because it is touched about the Bible. And I'm still waiting for this pseudo-intellectual Kyle to finally admit that since I brought Leviticus.
Let's all mute.
Because I have Tommy, you don't doesn't make me a pseudo-intellectual.
All right.
You're a pseudo-intellectual. You're you're a bit of a joke on this topic, and you shouldn't even be on this panel because you have the nerve to sit here and say the Bible doesn't talk about homosexuality.
Because I have the nerve to say shit. Have you listened to your track record? No. Look, the Christians hate you more than the atheists do. You're a joke. You're a fucking joke.
Name 10. Name 10.
You still haven't answered the question.
All right, yeah. Let's, name 10. All right, let's give me let Jade
finish. And you name one.
You see what he does? He tries to focus in on personal things rather than giving back for what he does because he's full of fucking shit.
Yeah, I'm not the one upset.
You're full of fucking shit, dude. You're full of fucking
GMAN is a person, guys.
Calm down. Yeah.
Okay.
Wax on, wax off. Breathe in.
Mute. Do not take offense. I'm going to mute. Do not take offense. Okay. Just chill out for
2 seconds. Not at all, Rob.
Who's Fab?
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, I mean, I do have a bit of a question, maybe a slight flippant question, but I want to know what G-Man's blood pressure is. Also, I've been told to inform him that Dragnaut Silvas will come in if he doesn't behave.
Okay.
May I ask?
I will block him. And actually, he can't come here because he's blocked. Number two, I'll leave. Because right. Well, I'm in here because he's Bionic, not because of
guys. Nobody gives a fuck.
I don't care about what Kyle's got to say. I don't. This biologist Brian. I'm going to invite him to.
That's right, bitch. That's right, you don't.
Okay. Let's let Jade say what she's got to say real quick, okay?
Anyway, Brian, I can help.
G-Man, grow the fuck up. Please.
You still haven't answered
that. That is so childish.
And I can prove it to you, man.
Stop it.
You still haven't answered.
Now, I wanted to ask a question. What I wanted to say, if you're claiming that homosexuals die earlier, I'm not going to ask you for your proof, but I'm going to ask you for your arguments. Why do you think homosexuals die earlier?
Depression. What? How about I just give you that one first? Depression.
Yeah,
is that all?
That's not an argument. Do you know how many people in this country suffer from depression, whether they're gay or straight or whatever?
I'm going to say depression. It's not an argument.
It's not an argument.
Whatever you people, think, it ain't an argument. Just like the word gay and homosexuality is. I'm sorry that homosexuality is not mentioned in scripture, right? So listen, you say whatever you want, Jay, because I'm sure you'll believe anything that comes out of your own mouth until you're corrected. I assure you.
And by the way,
that you're a lesbian.
You
are a lesbian. Now, the question is, are you going to repent of being a lesbian?
You are.
We're not asking
for a little way. I have no reason to repent of how God made me.
God made you gay? What? Can you show? Whoa. Can you prove that to me? Listen to me.
There is evidence that homosexuality has a genetic component, so yeah.
Hey, can you show me in the Bible where it says God made you gay?
So does a lamb choose to be gay, G-Man? Does a lamb choose to be gay?
People don't choose what genes they're born with.
Jade has a free will, and Jade, for some reason, maybe because of something that happened in her childhood, decides that she doesn't want
to
be
okay, you're going to have to stop right there. You're going to have to stop right there.
Well, you're going to have to meet me.
Because that is a...
Shut the fuck up, G-Man. Let her talk.
That is like a 1940s...
Mute for 2 seconds, G-Man. Don't take
that. That is like a 1940s, 1950s at the most idea of why people are gay because something happened in their childhood. That's not the way it works. There is lots of evidence showing that people are in fact born gay. You're born with and various other things. Some people are bisexual. Some people are asexual. Some people are heterosexual. Some people, you know, there are differences. We are born with a certain propensities. That's just the way it works. And there is lots of evidence in the scientific literature to demonstrate that. So no, I have nothing to repent of in being a homosexual. Absolutely nothing. This is the way I was made.
You're watching this, you heard it out of Jay's own mouth. You heard it out of her own mouth that she does not believe that homosexuality is a sin. Even though in the Old Testament you were stoned for being that way. And in the New Testament, you're going to be thrown in the lake of fire. And like I said,
no.
They used to own slaves. Does that make it right? They had slaves in the Bible, G-Man. Does that make it right?
No, it makes it wrong.
If I may, please.
Women should be quiet and let men teach.
It makes it fucking retarded.
Talking about arguments. They need to go to the
Next.
Better than that.
Next.
If I may.
Better than that, Jade.
Next.
If I may, I would like to reiterate that we don't really care about the laws of the Old Testament because Christians are under the New Covenant, which means the New Testament. And no, there is nothing in the New Testament that conclusively mentions homosexuals or homosexuality.
Let's go to Romans chapter 1. I'll prove you're a liar right now. Let's go to Romans chapter 1.
You said, man, go there. You got to let her finish, okay, man? Like, you want people to let you finish. Let other people finish, okay?
I apologize. She's whining, but let her lie. Go ahead.
I'm not lying. And see, this is one of the reasons that I think you're a piss-poor example of a Christian, is the way you casually accuse people of lying when it isn't true. You repeatedly bear false witness, and you never repent of it. You never stop doing it. And even if you have repented of it in the past, part of repentance is to make a decision not to do that in the future, and yet you continue to bear false witness. I mentioned that Romans is about temple prostitution and about people going back to using pagan practices. It's specifically to the church at Rome.
Let him go there. Jade.
So
two things. Number one, G doesn't have no proof of what she's saying. And then number one, G has no proof of what she's talking about. Number two, I have a study Bible here in front of me. And I'm going to read two verses that prove that this is talked about in the New Testament. Then I'm going to read the commentary. And then Jade's going to have to repent. Oh, okay. Jade doesn't believe in sin. That's right. My bad. Because that was the Old Testament. That's not New Testament. Right, Jade? Romans chapter 1, verse 24. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. Can read that again. Wherefore, God gave them up to uncleanness through
the lust. Okay. Somebody have to mute him. Somebody else to mute him right now.
Wait a minute.
Please mute him.
Hold on.
He's hurting my ears.
G-Man, let's not yell, all right?
Can I finish
G-Man reading my Bible verse, you coward?
Can I finish reading my Bible verse, you coward?
No, you can, no. G-Man, you can say it, but don't scream it.
I'm going to leave right now.
Go away. We'll do it without you.
You're a coward, man. G-Man knows. G-Man knows that I have hearing problems.
No, that's an infamous situation. I'm doing that because of the Hebrew Israelites. It's an inside joke. You don't even know what you're talking about, Jade.
Somebody, you're hurting my ears.
Wherefore, God also
gave my headphones off. My
cleanness. Your ears don't look too bad to me. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness.
Can you fucking grow up?
2 seconds, G-Man. Seriously, let's not yell. You do know about Jade's about ears problem because.
So I'm not going to be allowed to read my Bible verse.
No, you're going to be to just
Bible verse. Don't try to be. You're not a sportsman.
But I'm trying to read a Bible verse, and you
so read it instead of being a sports announcer. How hard is that?
You just want me to listen to you, apparently.
No, go ahead and read it. Go ahead and read it. Go ahead and read it.
Okay, great. Matthew chapter 24.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth about God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forevermore. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up to vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. You guys should try reading some of the other translations. This part might be more blunt. And likewise, also the men leaving the natural use of women burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men working that which is unseemly and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error. Now, let's read what the commentary has to say now here, because according to her, it has to do with temple prostitution and whatnot, right? Okay, it says, hold on a minute. Men with men. The apostle likely regarded homosexual and lesbian abomination as the greatest evidence of human degeneracy resulting from immorality and abandonment of God. Now, I'm not going to read anything else here. All I have to do is actually just show you what it says here, Jade. Just because you, a woman who's not even a real believer, tries to give an explanation without backing it up with biblical scholars who aren't gay, by the way. You know what I mean? Or anything like that and whatnot. And I talk about the people Frankie, who put together
read James Jade, I'm almost speaking on your behalf. Right. He's completely bastardizing that. Just for a second, okay? I'm going to read this, okay? And I want everybody to pay attention so that you understand where this verse is coming from. Because this is, like you said, from the book of Romans.
He's talking about heterosexual people who refuse to acknowledge and glorify God. They began worshiping idols, were most interested in earthly pursuits than spiritual pursuits, and gave up their natural, i.e. innate passions for the opposite sex in unbound search for pleasure. The behavior Paul was addressing here is explicitly associated with idol worship, probably temple prostitution, and with heterosexual people who, in an unbridled search for pleasure, religious rituals associated with their idolatry, broke away from their natural sex orientation, participate sex with anyone available.
No, keep reading.
Now,
talking about homosexuality.
When men lie with other men, that's exactly what they're talking about. They're leaving their...
When a man lies with
their...
another man, that is a person who has a reprobate mind. Read the entire chapter, okay? So it's a person with a reprobate mind who...
Yeah, but reading it out of context, he's talking about sexual promiscuity. Now, I'm sorry, Jimmy, hold on. Promiscuity.
That's what it's talking about, Kyle. You don't know what you're talking about.
That's what we're talking about. Don't lie about your own book, dude. Don't lie about your own book.
I'm lying about my own book, bro. I know what
I'm
my
better
book
prepared.
Is. I do this perfect.
I'm better prepared.
I do this all the time, dude.
You know what? You know who needs to read their Bible and do what it says?
Yeah, I do. I do. I do what my Bible is. I do read
your Bible. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here spouting that bullshit.
Who are destroying our society? Lying about
fly with me.
Justifying
you. I'll get you up and down this hangout with your own Bible. I'll give you that it's true. I'll grant you that it's true. You won't make it out alive here with me in your book. I promise you that.
Well, I'll just kind of set that homosexuality.
Bring your verses, bitch. Bring your verses.
Admit that you're right. I mean, admit that you're wrong. Admit that you're wrong.
I thought.
Read Leviticus and then tell me how homosexuality is not in the Bible. Read what I just got
Leviticus
in Romans 1 and tell me how it's not in the Bible.
Which part of Leviticus are we going to? I've got my notes right here. Which part of Leviticus are we going to? Which part of Leviticus are we going to? Oh, now you don't have a verse.
Leviticus,
that's what I thought.
I think it's Leviticus 18.
Give
right?
me a verse, bitch, man.
No. I already did. Two appearances. I read it earlier. Are you going to make me believe you? You're going to pretend that nobody
give
actually read
verse.
That
to give me a verse.
Two appearances gave you the verse earlier. That's in Leviticus.
I'm asking you. You're the one that's – true empiricism's been actually very well-mannered about this. You're the one that gets on and is obsessed for some reason. I wonder why you're obsessed with it, but you can't stop talking about homosexuality.
The way you're acting right now. Everybody watching.
Send it after tonight.
Hey, why
true empiricism ain't in this battle, but dude. You are. So give me a verse.
I got food. So just keep running your mouth and lying. That's what you ate these known for, lying.
Give me a verse.
Okay, again, in the book – I don't. You know what? Let me ask you something. Since you're so much
that's
of a Bible,
what I thought, bitch, man.
Wait. Jesus quoted scripture.
No, wait. Nothing. Next.
All I got to do is tell you in Leviticus, it teaches that you get the death penalty if you commit
which
homosexual
verse?
Acts.
Which verse?
If you don't believe that, it's not my fault that you don't know what you're talking about.
Do you wear clothes that are mixed with polyester and cotton?
Well,
then you would be put to death too.
Hold on. Let me see. Nope, this is 100% cotton. But even if it was, I wouldn't be a sinner. Because I know the totality.
What's your hat made of?
God, you don't. And you don't listen very well.
What's your hat made of?
My hat? I think my hat's made out of cotton. But even if it was.
The threads.
Kyle, your argument is for a Hebrew Israelite, not for me, dude. You don't even know what you're doing.
I have a question for Jimmy.
Yes, I do.
I am arguing for the.
I don't know who you're doing. It's you, my friend. It's you.
That's why you're an atheist.
Do you wear clothes that have mixed linens in them?
I don't listen.
Do you wear clothes that have mixed linens in them? Yes or no?
I'm not under the Mosaic law.
It's two verses later.
I'm not under the Mosaic law. Do you understand the word coming out of my mouth?
So how would homosexuality is in that same verse? So it's not under the law either.
Well,
and I'm assuming that your book is true.
How many times did the dietary law change?
Joke.
Testament.
Really? I mean, in reality, it's a
dietary law change in the Old Testament. How many times did the dietary law change in the Old Testament? Why are you afraid to answer my question? So, you don't know nothing about the Old Testament law. I asked you how many times the dietary law was changed in the Old Testament. You know what you're saying to me?
You live in your own.
Making yourself like an idiot. But you don't even want to answer the question. Well, the dietary law was changed three times.
I don't want to answer a question.
Three times in the Bible. Okay? And it even affects the New Testament. At one time, man could not eat meat. Okay? First, he was told to eat the fruit of the eat the fruit and the vegetables that grew on the trees and on the ground and whatnot. Then God said that they could eat animals, but limited on what they could eat. And then in the law, they couldn't eat swine. In the New Testament, that it was clean and ugly animals. In the New Testament, we can eat whatever we want, provided that the blood is not in it. And this is in Acts chapter 15, sir. If you actually read your Bible, okay? It tells you that you can eat whatever you want, provided that the life of the blood is not in the animal, and that you give God thanks when you eat the food. One thing I noticed about you, Kyle, is you ask me questions, but you don't like when I answer them. And you don't answer
questions. You just answered it.
Right. He's answered it. See, what happens is, G-Man, you quoted a verse about Leviticus that has to do with stoning homosexuals, and I'm telling you that in that same chapter, it talks about wearing mixed linens. And your claim is that in the New Testament, we can eat whatever we want, or it doesn't count with shrimp. But my point is that if it – you can't say that homosexuality gets picked out above the mixing. Like, now you can wear mixed cotton, but you can't –
That is because I'm talking about two different covenants. First of all, you need to understand something. That Mosaic law that is mentioned in the Old Testament was done under Moses.
Explain it to this fucking idiot.
You know what? Why don't you guys invite me here so that this guy can just overtalk me and not let me say anything?
You're trying to overtalk him at the same
time. You don't want to stay here.
I've been doing the same thing at the same time.
I got some choice words for you on my main channel, dude. The bottom line is this is
that gets on all 200.
Can I respond, please, guys?
Let's respond, yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to say I had to step out for a second because somebody came over and knocked on the door. So I did miss a good portion of what you guys were saying. But it sounded like towards the tail end of what I caught, you guys were speaking about the law and the New Testament. Am I getting that right?
I wanted to interrupt for just a second because I could have sworn. I could have sworn that's what I fucking thought. That's what I motherfucking thought. Now, what did I fucking tell him ages ago? Don't talk shit to people or I will find you. I'm not sure what part of that he doesn't seem to understand. But, G-Man, this is only the beginning. So you can take your butthurt ass back to your channel because I'm going in on your ass double now. If you think I'm in your ass now, you can't
Drag, what is this?
Oh, I've been watching. I've been having a grand old time. A grand old time. You
just exhibited some of that bitch made Kyle was talking about.
So yes, I coined hashtag bitch made for a fucking reason. For a goddamn reason. It's because bitches like that. That's why. So, hi, y'all. I'm Dragnut.
Hey, how you doing?
Been waiting to get in here.
Oh, fuck okay, me.
That was lightning fast. Holy shit.
Y'all see? That is how you have an impact on him. That, ladies and gentlemen, is how you get him to calm down. So, the next time he acts up, let him know that I am nearby. Okay?
Okay, so I'd like to actually respond to...
Can we shoot your avatar up into the sky, like, or something?
Go ahead, Drew.
Yeah, I was just going to try to hit on what was said and mentioned earlier. If we're talking about the covenants, the two covenants, I think that what G-Man was saying, what I caught towards the tail end of it, is correct. The book of Galatians talks about the allegory of the bondwoman and the free woman, and to cast out the bondwoman, for she will not partake of the inheritance of the free woman. Specifically, it talks about this being an allegory for the two covenants. Yeah, okay. Galatians chapter 2 and 3, it talks about...
Sorry.
Okay, sorry. Go ahead. Keep going, Drew.
Well, I'm going to take off, guys. Have a nice day, everybody.
All right.
See ya.
Salute.
Antonio, you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Step up to the plate.
Well, I just got one more quick question before I take off because I got to go real soon. Because given my immediate circumstances, the only way I can participate in Hangouts is on a library laptop right now until I get a new one. But anyway, I just got a question for Kyle before I take off. Are you saying that the Bible conclusively... does not say homosexuality is a sin, or are you saying that we can't know either way?
I'm saying that we can't know either way. Now, I granted, I'm coming from a bias. I don't believe the book at all. However, I think what the verses that we can point to, and the fact that that word that Paul uses for homosexual is not a it's not a genuine translation of what the word means, because it's only used in context in those two verses that it's mentioned in, and they both, what everybody says, points to homosexuality. My point is that I'm looking at it from a just a standpoint of a of looking at Christians and wondering why they're so obsessed with homosexuality being a sin, because it affects them none. And then you have people like G-Man who spout off hate. And the only reason I'm here is not because G-Man bothers me. I don't give a fuck about G-Man, but he came after Jade, and Jade's a Christian. I'm an atheist, but Jade does nothing to harm anyone. She minds her own business. She adds to conversations. She's intelligent. She just wants to be who she is. She wants to be who she is, love who she wants to, and believes what she wants to believe. And why that's a problem for anybody, I don't know. But you can best believe that I'll be back up in here to slap the fuck out of anybody that tries to make that a problem. Because you guys want to believe whatever you want to believe as Christians. You talk all the time about your religious freedoms being in jeopardy. But the moment that somebody else tries to do that, then it's, oh, wow, the Lord says this. Who gives a fuck? You have no reason for believing what you do. None. Period. Zip. Nada. Zilch. So Jade's going to be whatever Jade wants to be. I'm going to be whatever I want to be. And if anybody else has anything to say about it, they can fuck off.
Very well fucking said. Sorry.
I would define, you know, reasons to believe something. I would say that we have a very good reason to believe things that God tells us, because all I can tell you is that in my immediate experience in my life, I've personally felt the movement of the Holy Spirit, and I've seen the evidence and how He operates in my life. So I do believe I do have reasons to believe what He says, even if that means...
Oh, no. Let me clarify. Antonio, let me clarify real quick. I didn't mean that you don't have reasons to believe in God. I'm perfectly fine with you believing whatever you want to believe. I have no issue with that. Where my issue comes in is when you come in here trying to call out people for loving who they want to love. When something that's not your issue becomes your issue, then I have a problem with it. But if you want to go off and believe in God and live a peaceful life and not bother anybody, more power to you. I have no interest in taking away anybody's religion. They're free to believe whatever they want to believe. I have a problem with people trying to step on the toes of those just trying to live a peaceful existence. And I think it's horrible and bullshit, and I'm not going to stand for it.
Well, here's the thing, man. I can look at things like fornication, for example. I don't really know why God says it's a sin to not do that before one is in a married union. But ultimately, if I really believe what God's telling me and I'm going to be consistent, I'm going to follow what He says.
That's fine.
I mean, how would you expect me to operate any other way if I was going to be a Christian and be one consistently? Are you going to consistently follow
I would expect you not to make it your problem. I would expect, if Jade's not bothering you, to leave Jade the fuck alone. You may not like what Jade does. You may not agree with what Jade does, but it doesn't concern you. So stay the fuck out of it.
Well, here's the thing.
To be clear, Antonio has always been very polite.
I'm sure he has. He seems like he is, but I'm not yelling at Antonio personally.
I know. I just wanted to make that clear.
Yeah, he's getting the blunt of my anger directed at this. This even has to be a hangout, because Jade, you don't bother anybody, and this is where I'm going at Antonio. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you believe, and it's fine that you have your opinion that what I do is wrong. You may think that what I do is a sin. I'm perfectly fine with that. I'm not trying to sway you over to that side. I'm not trying to sway you out of how you practice your Christianity. I'm trying to sway people out of the mindset that they have the right to dictate what other people do based on what I think is an imaginary sky daddy. That makes no sense whatsoever. So you do you, Antonio. You be Antonio. But let Jade be Jade.
Well, here's the thing, man. I'm not going to say that ultimately you can't make whatever choice you want to make with how you're going to live your life. Because, I mean, From my worldview, God's going to judge us on things that we do. And I'm not going to say, like for example, I don't think it's right for people to get drunk and mess their lives up that way, but I'm not going to tell you you can't drink or anything like that. I'm not going to tell you that. I think it's wrong, and I would specifically speak out against it as a sin, but I'm not going to tell you not to do it, though. I'm not going to tell you not to do it in the sense that you have no right to do that in your own life. I'm going to speak against it as a sin, and I'm not going to compromise that. But if I truly believe that God is telling me these things, and I truly believe that there's a hell waiting for people who are doing these things, it would be irrational, it would be immoral for me not to warn you about it. It would be just like if I knew someone was going to take your life, and I had conclusive, irrefutable information of that fact, and I didn't say anything to you
right there,
and I didn't warn you, I didn't warn the police or anything.
Once again, that would be, it's just like you compare, and I'm not going to let you get away with that, Antonio. I'm sorry, but I'm not going to let you get away with comparing these two things. Somebody trying to kill themselves is not the same in any way. Understand this. Shape or form the same as somebody who is homosexual. Because unlike you guys, people who are homosexual like me, I mean, I am fucking fabulous. And there is negative about me. And that, comparing the two things, comparing a negative to a negative or a positive, is not the same thing. Just like, let me ask you this. What if I compared your Christianity to bestiality? What if I said Christians know better than people who fuck animals? How would you feel about that, Antonio? Because let me tell you something. And I may truly think that. I think both people are batshit crazy, but I don't come out loud and say that. I don't compare you directly to your face like that. And I think that's wrong. And I think that you are completely idiotic to a level that I've never seen before to be able to say that out in public.
Well, I'm not. See, my point wasn't even about comparing one thing to anything necessarily. That wasn't even the necessary point I was attempting to make. What I'm getting at is, if I truly believe that something's going to happen, and, you know, I'm in a position to where I have particular information and I'm not warning you about it, would that be immoral for me not to warn you about it? Even well-known atheists.
But the thing you want to warn about is something that we feel is made up in your head. It's something that doesn't exist. If there was a terrorist attack that was imminent, that would be one thing. But you're withholding evidence about Candyland. That's what you're saying. I have evidence that Candyland exists. Well, I have to warn them before they get thrown into a mud pit. It's the same thing. Well, she doesn't believe that. She doesn't believe she's going to go to hell. So it's not your concern to tell her about it. It's not your concern. Stop putting yourself in places that worry about you. What's that verse? Let's go to Bible verses. Let's go to Bible verses. What does that talk about? A log in your eye or the splinter in somebody else's eye before you worry about the log in your own? Get the log out of your eye first, Antonio, and then come talk to Jade about the splinter in her eye.
Well, can I break this up for a second, gentlemen? Can I break this up for a second?
Let's not go on a rabbit trail. I didn't even get to finish my point at all.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. I want to get a good Kyle. Kyle's getting heated.
But I want to go on a rabbit trail here. I mean, whether you believe me or not, it's not the point. The point is that if I tell you these things and I think that they're going to happen to you, after I tell you and inform you about it, what you do with that information is up to you. You don't have to believe me. My job as a Christian isn't to get you to believe me. My job is just to do what Jesus says. What you do with that information thereafter is up to you. But I'm not going to...
Let me say one thing.
Wait a minute. I got to ask something. What does Jesus say specifically to do to homosexuals? Because if what Jesus says is something like cast them to the flames or whatever, I mean, are you going to do that? Or are you going to question whether or not what Jesus says is actually a good thing to do? I mean, is there anything Jesus could tell you to do where you'd go, oh, no, that's over the line?
And to piggyback before you answer, Antonio, let me tell you this. You telling somebody your personal feelings, like if you pulled Jade aside and said, this is how I feel, this is what I think, that's one thing. But that's not what we're here talking about. What we're here talking about is somebody that gets on here day after day spouting hate and bigotry about somebody that has done nothing to them, period. That's what this is about. You're free to believe whatever you want to believe, and you may want to message Jade privately, but we're talking about somebody who pulled her into the public sphere over something that has nothing to do with him. That's okay, the difference. I still want to know how
blind his faith is.
Fiona has a question for Antonio.
Can I get an answer?
Fiona's been waiting, so could we just let Fiona go, please?
Yeah, I'm sorry about this. I've come in for a specific reason, and you may think this is slightly dragging it off topic. There is a question for Antonio, but I'll just explain the background for this, okay? About a year ago, I had a hangout. And in that hangout, G-Man pulled out a bullhorn and screamed in the hangout. Now, we told him that this hurt Jade's ears because she wears hearing aids. She has a hearing problem. And very loud noises cause her physical pain. Whereupon, G-Man screeched down the bullhorn again. And towards the end of the hangout, he attempted it and Dragnaut stopped him. We all watched in here as G-Man, reading from his Bible, screamed out the passage. And when told again about Jade's hearing problem, which was caused by measles as a child, G-Man said, "Your ears look fine to me. Can you condone that behaviour, Antonio?" He caused physical pain to Jade, knowing that he would cause her physical pain in this hangout while you and True Empiricism were in here. Can you defend him doing that?
Well, of course I'm not going to defend that at all.
And did you do anything to actually say to him, "Hey, man, stop it"? Or did you just sit here and say nothing to him while he publicly condemned Jade? If you want to sit and publicly condemn Jade for being a celibate homosexual, then get off your arse and condemn your pal G-Man for deliberately causing unnecessary physical pain to someone knowingly. Do you understand what I'm saying, Antonio?
Well, number one, you don't really know what kind of conversations I have with him. And number two, there was certain things like that was out of pocket. That was wrong. I agree. But that wasn't the only thing that was worthy of condemnation, if you will. There were many things that were said to G-Man that I thought was messed up, too. But you didn't hear me say a word, though, did you? So if you can
Antonio,
if you're going to talk about condemning actions, you need that, to point it out on both sides, not just, you know, point out things that he do that I was also silent about. Are you going to say that I'm permitting the things that I was silent about on the other side too?
Look, what I'm saying to you is this.
Brother in Christ.
Yes. You're so busy trying to correct Jade. You're all in here trying to condemn homosexuality. You're all in here condemning and trying to correct Jade. But what he did in here caused her physical pain, and he knew it. He knew it, Antonio. He went out of his way to cause her physical pain. Now, if you want to publicly condemn Jade for being a celibate homosexual, then you can publicly condemn him for deliberately causing physical pain to Jade, because it was explained to him in my hangout why it caused physical pain to Jade. And that physical pain can last for well over a day, and it also affects her balance if that happens. He was injuring her.
They came in and they tried to condemn homosexuality. They did not succeed. Action, they tried.
I will say that action is wrong. It should not have been done. Will I condemn him? I'm not going to condemn anybody because that's not my job. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to say it's wrong or sinful. I will say what he did was wrong. Absolutely.
And for the record, my ears still hurt. Yeah. Thank you, G-Man. I really appreciate that.
I'm so sorry that happened, Jade. I tried to catch it. I remember I watched that same one that Drag has on the, right now.
Yeah.
And I try to catch it as soon as I can because I knew.
Oh, right I know. It's hard, you know, because you're listening to conversations and to catch it. I had to throw my headphones off. It was that bad. And
That's the reason I jumped in here because I was like, you see, I'm sitting there and it pissed me the fuck off too because he does malicious shit like that. But you know what, gentlemen? Since he likes to be malicious, I remember that. I remember sitting in that hangout and I remember talking to Jade afterwards. And so when I met this fucker, I squeezed his hand and he fell to his fucking knees. He fell to his knees like a bitch. So if he's upset about homosexuality, it's because he was on his knees in front of me.
I'm sure he does that anyway.
So
can I jump in here real quick and remind him of that?
Hold on. I asked the question a few minutes ago, and I really would like an answer. Antonio, how blind is your faith? Is there anything that Jesus could ask you to do where you'd go, nah, that's over the line. I cannot in good conscience do that to someone else.
Well, the first thing is I really disagree with the premise of your question. Like, I think you alluded to earlier, like Jesus asking me to like kill homosexuals or something like that. What was it that you said?
I don't remember specifically. It's been several minutes. But my point is that if Jesus told you something that twinged your conscience, would you still do it just because Jesus said it?
Well, here's the thing. There are certain things that I don't understand about God's character in which do trouble me. And I do go against them many times, but that is me sinning. I mean, so just because there are times to where something that doesn't sit well with me and I sin against them, does that mean that my conscience being offended is some sort of actual issue of the rightness or wrongness or whatever? Because here's the bottom line. If there is no God, then we don't really have any ultimate moral framework to even talk about, and we can get into that conversation anyway. But if there is one, then that's a conversation that I think rightfully goes into that particular framework. So quite frankly, I don't even think we can rationally have that discussion if God doesn't exist in the first place.
One of us can't.
But I mean, but you say that God does exist, and my question was about basically your loyalty, your faith, and how you justify it.
Say that again.
I said that even if right now, just hypothetically, let's assume that God does exist. My question was about your loyalty, your faith, your willingness to do what you're told, whether or not it's something that you find odious or obnoxious or something. I mean, that was my question. You kind of answered it. The thing is that, I mean, if God doesn't exist and we have no ultimate morals, and I don't think we have ultimate morals even if God does exist, because there's still God's subjective opinions. Well, one thing we do know is that hurt, and I don't want it done to me again. And I'd probably prefer if it wasn't done to anyone I love. And there's your basis for morality. And homosexuality, to bring us full circle, doesn't really hurt anybody. The people who engage in it don't object to it. So why should we condemn it? I mean, I realize that covered a lot of ground, but still.
But here's the thing, though. I'll go back to what I said again, and that's the fact that something that God tells me to do may, in fact, bother my conscience. If it bothers my conscience, well, so what? That's the first part of that. But the other part of that is I don't see at all in God's nature where he would ask me to do something like kill homosexuals. So if you're going to, you know, use some sort of hypothetical to try to drive a point, like if God told you to, like, kill homosexuals, or if God would tell you to do something like rape children or something like that, there's nothing that I can see in God's nature which you would ask me to do such things to begin with.
Well, so, you get in Leviticus.
The point is, well, if something offends my
my emotional sensibilities, and that has nothing to do with what he asked me to do.
Why not?
So you're following blindly.
This is what I'm saying.
You have no moral compass on your own.
I disagree with that premise. No,
you're moral.
It's okay.
Well, anyway, I guess that's as much of an answer as I'm going to get. I yield the floor.
Yep.
I got a question, Antonio, if you don't mind.
Sure, go ahead.
So you talked about, you expressed doubt about the idea of God telling you to kill homosexuals. So my question is, going back to Leviticus 20:13, where it says to kill homosexuals, if a man sleeps with a man as with a woman, they have both committed a detestable act. I'm reading from the CSB. They must be put to death. Their death is their own fault. So I guess my question is, if a reason for a law, I mean, clearly this is something that's in the Bible, in the Old Testament. If a reason for the law doesn't apply to you, then the obligation to follow that law or command is not there, right? Is that something you agree with?
Well, I mean, you see, a lot of people don't like to get into this subject. I don't really like to say, you know, if a reason would follow or not follow, because that seems to like separate reason from God's nature. And I believe that the foundation of reason is God himself.
Well, I'm talking about I'm not talking about reason in like an esoteric or logic sense. I'm talking about the justification for a law or a command existing in the first place. Like think of the distinction between the spirit of the law versus the letter of the law. If God says do this or don't do this, and his reason for doing that or telling you to do that or not do that no longer applies, then you're no longer obligated to follow that command, right? I mean, that's the whole basis for the distinction between an old and new covenant in the first place, is that the old covenant doesn't apply because it's fulfilled its reason and we no longer have a reason to obey it.
What do you mean, justification by what standard?
The intent, the intention for the law. If the intent for why a law was given no longer applies, you're no longer obligated to follow it.
Hold on. Let me mute real quick. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm talking about intent. If the intent for a law no longer applies, then you're no longer obligated to follow it. That's the whole basis for the distinction between the spirit of the law and the letter of the law, as well as the distinction between the old covenant and the new covenant. Sorry, Godless Iowan, I know you want to say something. The whole reason I bring this up is, and I'll cede the floor in like 15 seconds. The whole reason I bring this up is because all the evidence we have about homosexual sex from the ancient world that pertains to the ancient Near East, to the Israelites, is that homosexual sex was viewed as being, was viewed in terms of its pagan connotations. There's no modern conception of committed same-sex relationships anywhere in the literature or in the archaeology of the ancient Near East. So we have absolutely no evidence that there's this universal applicability, or there's this universal context for homosexuality. So it's the people who say that homosexual sex is universally condemned, those are the ones that are taking the Bible out of context.
Good point.
Yeah. So a couple things that I want to say here is, Bionic Dance, I'll answer the question for you, because I was a former fundamentalist for 10 years, homosexual condemning, hate spewing, basic garbage. And I'll just say, yes, if God had appeared before our church and said, go out and kill the homosexuals, people would have gone out and killed the homosexuals. It's an awful thing to say, but it's true. Secondly, I wanted to make a point and say that, Kyle, you made a godless Iowan straw man sweat tonight, and I am perfectly straight.
That was some fire. I liked it.
If I may break in really quickly, I'm about an hour delinquent for feeding Her Majesty, so I'm going to make like a baby and head out. Uh-oh. I'll catch you guys like the plague.
Bye, man.
Well,
I like you know, the calm side of me and getting along with everybody. I have several Christian friends that have made through the show, you know, through our show that we have. We have Christians come through all the time, and every single one of them will, you know, I have good things to say about. I have friends that are Christians. I used to be Christian, and they are you know, and loving, kind of like what Jesus said to be. You know, I don't may not believe that, but I think that if you're going to be, if you're going to try to preach a message of and you want to bring people closer to what he's doing, is not the way to go about it at all. If I was somebody that was on the fence, I mean, he honestly, he is the poster boy for atheism. I mean, he really is. He is the best driver to atheism that I've ever seen. Reason and logic speak to G-Man driving people to atheism. And it's because and his bigotry and his homophobia, you know, being did nothing to anyone whatsoever. And that's the reason I care, because I don't care one bit what it's not one bit. Somebody who's nothing but nice and tries to have intelligent conversations. The reason he's doing that is because she's liked by both sides. Down to it's a homosexuality thing. Atheist likes atheists. They have conversation that pisses him off. That's what it's about. So that's why I'm here. And you know, you very rarely see the side of me. And I'm like, somebody needed to put that dope in his place.
Well, Kyle, the last thing they wanted to point out was when G-Man was talking about Levitical laws and the Levitical laws that we don't have to follow them again because of the New Testament. Well, the point I'd like to make on that is Jesus in the New Testament says that not one jot or tittle from the old law is to pass away until he returned. It was actually the Council of Jerusalem in the book of Acts that came together, and it's kind of funny because the Christians back then even couldn't get along, and they decided, you know what, we're not going to really worry about the food laws anymore. As long as, you know, there's no blood in the meat, it's okay then. But yeah, he brought up the Levitical laws, and then when you called him on it, it was, oh, we don't have to follow that. Well, that's not what Jesus said actually in the New Testament.
No blood in the meat. That's just that's like G-Man. He gets a well done steak. Fuck that.
No, that's not on. True, because Jesus said he came to. Oh, go ahead.
Now, as far as the thing about one John one till, what's missing from this conversation is that, in Christian theology, we have three distinctions of the law. We have civil law, we have judicial law, and we have the moral law. Now, there are particular laws that apply. That applied in that time that don't apply today. Those would be more ceremonial or judicial.
So how do you know that homosexuality isn't a ceremonial law?
What's that?
We have a former pastor right here, Antonio. Why don't you ask the former pastor?
Well, I'm not saying that he don't know certain things or whatever. What I'm telling you is, whether you a pastor or not, anybody can find these things that I'm telling you in Christian theology.
I'd say he's a little bit of an expert, though. He might know a thing or two. No.
What's the
awkward? He's saying there's distinctions in the law that we have to follow. There's a moral law and a civil, some other bullshit. Antonio, clarify whatever you're saying.
No, it's okay. There's civil law. There's moral law, and then there's ceremonial law. Those are three distinctions of law. There are laws which apply in certain places and times that don't apply in other places and times. Like, you know, there are certain dietary laws that only apply for the Israelites, but they apply for a very specific purpose because God wanted to separate the Israelite people from the rest of the world so that Jesus may be descended through the line of the Israelites. He separated them from the rest of the world because he called them to be holy in the same way that he separates regenerative Christians from the rest of the world. You know, we would be the salt of the world. We are in the world, but not of the world. He separates us from everybody else. So that's the reason why it may seem to be contradictory that we don't follow certain laws today that the Israelites followed back then, but it's not contradictory at all. If you look at the moral context which exists of, I'm not the moral context, but the type of law context we're talking about in Christian theology.
What you're talking about there, especially when you said the moral laws that were specifically for the Israelites, Christianity was a Jewish religion. And it wasn't until the book of Acts that they came together and they decided that certain things were okay now because there were Gentiles entering the faith. What I spoke of before is from Matthew 5:17 and 18. It says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For I tell you truly, until heaven and earth pass away, not a single jot, not a stroke of a pen will disappear from the law until everything is accomplished." So Jesus was saying that the law was still in play, even though he was fulfilling them. It was then later in the Bible when Gentiles started to enter the picture and the Pauline writings started to come into play that things started to get muddy there. And I'm agreeing totally that it was a pagan practice was what they were talking about in the Old Testament. Because if you look at the context of the other things surrounding homosexuality in that context, it was about paganism in the Old Testament. And then in the New Testament, it's also about prostitution.
If I could ask a question.
Well, here's anyone else?
He's talking about one jot and one tittle. I think it's quite clear that he's talking about the moral law. That's the reason why that we still have to be under laws like thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit murder. Thou shalt not bear false witness. I think those laws apply in all places and all times.
Where is the distinction made between the civil, the moral, and the legal law in the law of Moses?
Say that again, please.
Where is the distinction made in the law of Moses between civil, legal, and moral laws? Does Moses say this is civil? And then he goes through a bunch of things, and then this is legal, and then this is moral.
I'm sorry, man. I'm having so many problems hearing you, dude.
I know that Jade. I know not Jade. Fiona has a question.
Yeah.
So let's. We can go back to that one, but let her go ahead and say something.
Could you hear me?
Yeah, I was. Jennifer. I've been listening to the various Jennifer. Passages.
Could
getting
bandied
about.
Hold on, give me 2 seconds.
Just fine?
Yes.
I mute you, Godless, but go ahead, Bjorn.
Okay. Yeah, I've been listening to various passages getting bandied around, and I have noticed they all have one thing in common. They are actually talking about homosexual acts, okay? Just as an example, Leviticus. If a man lies with a man, as he lies with a woman. So getting very specific here again, seeing as it's Jade that G-Man has gone after. Can anybody tell me who a celibate lesbian may be lying with?
Oh, me. Herself. She looked at herself in the mirror too long and she committed sin.
Because if you look at those passages, they do actually talk about the deed itself, okay? And we have various explanations as to why that is there. Temple prostitution, blah, 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 all the rest of it. But bringing it back, pulling it back even further to a celibate homosexual, who is a celibate homosexual lying with? The answer is nobody. It might come as a shock to some, but they're lying with nobody. So why go after Jade?
Well, can I respond to that, please?
Yep.
Can anyone hear me at all? I'm having problems hearing people in the room.
Yep.
Unfortunately, we can. Loud and clear.
Well,
okay. The way that I look at it is like this. You say, you know, she's celibate and who was that hurting? But the thing is, it doesn't hurt anyone that, you know, I see a woman in passing and, you know, I'm like, whoa.
Don't you do it, Antonio.
I would like to, you know, have such and such experiences with that woman. Like, that doesn't hurt anybody.
I mean, I didn't say anything about hurting anybody. I didn't mention that. I didn't bring that up. That's not what I asked you. What,
I'm having such a hard time hearing everybody. I'm trying. Go ahead.
Right. Okay. Given that we have the passage which says, if a man lies with a man as he lies with a woman, so it's talking about the actual act, who is a celibate homosexual lying with?
So, see, that's what I'm getting at, I guess, is that why do you presume that, you know, someone has to actually physically lie with somebody to sin?
Because that's what it says in Leviticus. If a man lies with a man as with a woman, that is what it's describing as an abomination. If a man lies with a man, who is a celibate homosexual lying with?
Well, if we got to engage in a physical action, then Jesus wouldn't have said, if you even look at a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery with her in your own heart, because that's right. Not just the physical act, things of the heart, too.
Right. Yeah, there's okay. A problem with that, though, Antonio, and that is that...
Can I finish, please?
Well, just want to point out that verse is not about... the culture of the time was that people were either arranged to be married or were married already. So when Jesus said, if you've committed adultery, if you've look upon a woman with lust, you were either married or arranged to be married. So that would be adultery in your heart. That's what that verse means.
Cliff, please don't jump in.
Well, I know you mean well.
Go ahead, Fiona.
I was trying to take this somewhere, Antonio. Okay? You gave me the answer, you gave me the answer, and you're going to Matthew 5, verses 27 and 28. But if a man looks at a woman to lust after her, okay? Now, where are we getting the lust from in this with the celibate homosexual? You see, homosexuality is defined as same-sex attraction, and heterosexuality is defined as opposite-sex attraction. So are we taking the word attraction and using lust in its place there?
I don't even think that's the point. I think the point is
very much the point.
The point is, something does not have to be physical for you to still sin. Like, even hate my brother, like, for example, if I hate my brother, I've committed a murder. I committed murder against him in my heart. That's also what Jesus talks about.
Okay.
So now, why do we?
Right. Okay. So let's then consider. So same-sex attraction, you think, is committing lust of some sort because of the attraction part. Is that correct?
Well, I don't know if it's lust or not, but the point is this something that we can say that if we do this, God would just say, oh, this is nothing here. This doesn't contradict my moral nature or anything like that. And I do think there are sins which contradict this moral nature. I mean, if I'm sitting here thinking about, hating against another person, like Jesus said, if you even hate your brother, you have committed murder against him in your own heart. So, I mean, whether it's lust or not, I don't really know. But the point is very, very simple. There are sins which are not physical.
Okay, which are still great. Sin. That's great. Okay, so then we go to heterosexual attraction. And we apply your metric to that. Okay? So it, not physical, but it would still be a sin. Where are all your videos, or where are all G-Man's videos? God. Let me finish.
The guy didn't say that all non-physical sins were of a lustful nature.
I didn't say all. I didn't say all, Antonio. But what I'm pointing out to you is, if you want to use that standard for same-sex attraction, you have to apply it to opposite-sex attraction and this sinning in the heart. And I'll point out that that passage in Matthew says, if a man looks at a woman to lust after her. It's very specific in that. If a man looks at a woman to lust after her. Okay? Mm-hmm. Very specific. So where are all the videos calling out the male heterosexuals?
Well, they do. They call them out in fornicators. They call them out in adulterers. They call them out in all sorts of context.
You see,
it's that seems to go over the head of a lot of people, because when you're throwing gays and homosexuals or whatever you want to refer to them as, it's just, you know, throwing in bigotry and you're a hateful monster and blah, 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 blah. And all the other ones that are being equally called out gets...
Because it's none of your business, and we're tired of taking your shit, and we're not going to
anymore.
Here's
the thing. Fornication. Celibate homosexuals are certainly not fornicating, are they? Are they?
No, but again, we're not talking about physical sins. I don't know why I got to keep going back to that point.
Yeah, okay. Look, if you want to use that standard, you need to apply it to heterosexual attraction as well.
Can I try to approach this from a different angle? You know what an autonomic response is, Antonio?
No, what is it?
So we have certain things in our body that works automatically. You don't have to think about your heart beating. You don't have to think about breathing. You've never had to think about that ever in your life. I'm pretty sure you've walked past an attractive woman, and before you could recognize that that was a woman, your body started reacting at some point in time.
Of course.
Okay. That was an attraction. That was an automatic response from your autonomic nervous system. Well, that was induced from stimuli to your autonomic nervous system. So the demarcation between having an attraction that you cannot control and lusting here is not being drawn very very, very well by certain parties. You follow me?
Well, here's the thing. Would you say that those same kind of responses can be triggered from adults to children as well?
From what?
Here he goes, conflating.
All those sorts of responses can be triggered from adults to children. Would you say that that's not true?
He's saying, is it natural for an adult to get turned on by a child, I think.
And let's refer, not go there.
He's comparing the two. To,
so we're parents to pedophilia. Okay,
what,
so.
Why do people always have to do that? Why can't you stay on the subject and not run into pedophilia or bestiality or whatever the hell it is?
So,
why can't you just discuss the subject?
Jade, I want to do that. I want to do that. So
okay.
I want to do this. I like where he's going. So when you have that automatic response, that is akin to you being attracted to a child. That they're on the same level.
Well, whether they're on the same level or not, we can talk about that. What I'm getting at is...
Well, I want to answer from that, though, because that's what I want to... Before we continue, are those things on the same level? You being automatically attracted to a woman, and let's say if someone was attracted to a young child, are those on the same level for you?
As far as it's something that you can't control, and it just happens, you know, without your conscious acting on that thing, I would say they're exactly the same thing.
Okay, cool. Let's go. Cool. You want to expound upon that? Because that seems a bit odd that you would put them on the same level, but I would love to hear your rationale.
And a bit criminal.
I mean, this just depends on what perspective you want to go with this as. Like,
If you go from the fallen world, and there are people who have those sorts of desires, you know, as adults to children. But if we go at it from, I guess you could say, the secular worldview, it would just be, you know, some product of our evolution or lack of evolution. I don't know how you guys would approach it from that angle.
I wouldn't know because I'm not in people's heads. And I think that's kind of the interesting part about this is that if someone, because I bring my son to school on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I don't know who feels that way about him. I'm pretty sure out of tons of people we pass, someone probably does feel that. I don't know. I'm not in their head. When they act upon it, that's when they catch the beating. So from what you're saying, if I just so happen to pass a good-looking woman, I don't even realize it's a woman, and I feel that, that's the same as someone feeling that towards my child. None of us can help that. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Okay, so if this person then takes that and they dwell on it, does that turn to lust?
If they, you know, perpetually dwell in that and they kind of settle that in their spirit and, you know, saying that, you know, these desires are fine, but if I were to act on them in this more expanded way, then that's not a problem. That's a problem.
So they would then have to then probably be in close proximity to my child, or they would have to constantly think about my child in order to elicit that kind of feeling, correct?
Not necessarily to have that sort of auto response you were talking about, but to engage on that level, then yes.
So we're talking about something else that's no longer a part of an autonomic response.
Well, here's the thing. We're not just talking about autonomous responses, are we then?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, I wasn't, you know, I never made the point that, you know, an autonomous response, I think that's how you said it. I never made the point that such a response like that is sinful. Not anywhere in anything I've said have I said that.
Okay. And that's where a lot of us are drawing the demarcation between, because, and specifically, I'm going to pick on Jay for a minute. In order for her to actually have those feelings of lust, she has to first get to know someone. But for her to get to know someone, she has to not be celibate. You see kind of the issue here with what we're bringing up?
To a point, but here's my question for you. Now, if I were asked this, like, if you have those sorts of, I'm terrible with the pronunciation of that word, autonomous. If you were to have those sorts of desires and then say that if you were to act on them, they would not be wrong. I think that's the real question here.
Well, I don't think anyone's here gonna, if it is a sin to act upon those thoughts after you've dwelled on them and lusted, then that's a completely separate issue. But I'm talking about just having the propensity to have an attraction automatically with no thought required.
Just in that respect, I wouldn't say that's sinful at all in any context.
Okay, that is literally the crux of this entire issue. When G-Man is bringing up homosexuality and he brought up what Jade's scenario, well, it's unique because Jade is a demisexual. In order for her to even get to that level, to become lust, she would first have to know someone, but there's a roadblock. She's celibate. So she can't get to that level. So G-Man is essentially conflating having that automatic response between, you know, that and actively lusting after someone.
He's confusing Jade with me.
He's confusing
Here's the problem.
Attraction with lust. And that's the difference.
But here's the thing. I think in the autonomous context you were talking about, there's attraction in that context, and then there's attraction in, you know, the perpetual context, you know, that goes beyond just an anonymous response. There's two different contexts of attraction we're talking about here.
Sure. As you have your baseline attraction that's automatic, and then when we get into lust, that is an act, you would agree that's an active thing that someone would have to do, so mentally to perpetuate that lustful thinking.
Right. I guess we can distinguish it as passive versus active, maybe.
Sure. Sure. So yeah, let's do. I have no problem with doing that, because the interesting thing about this whole saga, this all started when G-Man decided to go after Jade, and of course I went after him. But the thing that he had said is that she is actively practicing homosexuality.
Yes, he said she was a practicing homosexual, even now, though he'd been told about 2 dozen times before that she's celibate.
And I've made several videos explaining. It's not his business. It is not. And that's a great point that Jade has been a practicing lesbian for quite some time. I think she's quite good at it, but she's retired. So she's,
go girl. Come back out of retirement. Despite G-Man.
So I mean she's not out there, you know, in the dating market. She's not out there lusting after people. She's doing her own thing, trying to be a godly woman, and now you have someone who's trying to be psychic and taking what little he knows about her and is running with it. And then when people are pointing out that he has a misunderstanding of first her position in her life and these concepts, that's where all the hoo-ha is about.
Antonio, hold on one second. Just chill for a second, okay? I'm gonna let you speak. I'm not trying to talk over you. It has nothing to do with you, actually. But let me just say this, and I don't say this often because I am an anti-theist, so I don't subscribe to any type of religion. I used to, but if there is a God, then he is proud of Jade and how she's handled herself and the example that she sets for everybody else. I have no question about that. If he exists, then Jade, he is most definitely proud of you in the way that you've handled yourself. I know he wouldn't be of me the way I handled myself tonight, but Jade, definitely keep doing your thing. If you want to come out of retirement, do it. I think either way, heaven's going to be a better place to have you if it does exist.
I'm going to say this real quick, Kyle, and saying if God does exist, he'd be proud of you too for sticking up for your fellow person.
Yeah, I like that too. Yeah,
thank you.
I think it's also worth mentioning temptation, which is, you know, Jade is avoiding temptation. She is celibate. She is, you know, denying the temptation. And that is, you know, the caving to the temptation, that's the sin. Jade is doing completely the opposite of that.
It's less that I'm denying the temptation, is that I don't get any temptation.
Yes.
Being demisexual, I have to know someone I have to develop a romantic relationship with someone before there's any sexual interest. So there's no temptation if there's no romantic relationship.
Yeah.
And I'm not having, and not only that, a relationship doesn't always have to be sexual to be fulfilling, because I've had romantic relationships that were not sexual, that were absolutely wonderful. Mm. So, you know, we humans are capable of more kinds of relationships. We're, you know, we have friends, we have close friends, we have intellectual companions. We have a wide variety of relationships with people, and we don't need to narrow them down into little tiny boxes, and because sometimes they overlap, and you can have a relationship with someone for years and then suddenly you realize how much you really love that person. So it's not that simple, but no, it's just that I am not geared that way. I'm not geared that way so that I look at someone and I get lustful thoughts. I find porn absolutely boring. It does nothing to me. It that's the way I'm geared.
On the other hand,
I can hear a beautiful piece of music and I'm transported to an incredible realm and I play music. I play the cello. I have had, I'll never forget once in a chamber music, we did a rehearsal and it went so perfectly. When we were done, we all looked at each other and one of the violinists said, "Anybody got a cigarette?" And we all started laughing because that's how we felt at that moment. So human passion, human emotion is not so narrow. And we need to embrace it as it exists, but we don't need to abuse it either. So I can't imagine a God who gives us this capability to have such incredible passion in so many ways is going to condemn people for being human.
Or for being the human that he made them to be from that perspective.
That, yeah, yeah.
I'd like to, because G-Man has done this, it's an abomination, using Leviticus, of course. But there's an interesting verse in Proverbs, or set of verses. There are six things that the Lord hates. Seven are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run haste to evil, or make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord amongst brothers. How many of those does G-Man apply to? I'd say at least four, or maybe possibly five. You know.
I'm going to say a lot.
Yeah. I mean, you know, when he starts, you know, making videos, you know, strawmanning people, and he already knows what they believe. When he made a video saying drag thinks that homosexuals get to go to heaven, well, drag's an atheist. He doesn't believe there is a heaven. You know,
Cliff so, Jumper. You know what I don't see on that list, Cliff Jumper?
Yeah.
You know what I don't see on that list?
I don't see
Yeah, being homosexual?
I don't see homosexuality on that list anywhere.
Yeah.
No, it also doesn't make it into the Ten Commandments.
No.
Look at that.
And I'd also like to mention, what was that? I mentioned in the outside chat, and I've mentioned this before, that for all the videos that are being made about various sins, I see few being made against the first and the worst sin. And that is the sin of pride. It is pride that caused the angels to fall from heaven.
Oh, that's good.
Well, that's an important thing, real quick, because I really gotta go.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming, Antonio.
Yep.
No problem. Thank you guys for having me. I'll just end on this thought together.
G-Man.
And I'll just end by just asking you this question, Jay. Now, I hear what you say about you being celibate, and I'm not gonna say what's going on in your head or not or anything like that. Well, we'll ask you is this. When you observe other people who still do those things physically, who would define themselves as gay or homosexual, would you say those people doing those things are wrong, biblically speaking?
No. I would say it's up to them and up to their conscience. And I am not God, and I am not the one who determines whether someone is sinning or not. There is a dearth of information about homosexuality in the Bible. And when we look at the adultery, for example, you know, people will bring up adultery and other sexual sins. What's really being talked about are violations of the second great commandment, and that is to treat others as we would wish to be treated ourselves. So it's violating a trust. So committing adultery is really more than just a sexual sin. Mm-hmm. Committing adultery is violating the trust of a person you have given a promise to. And same with
well, I would disagree with the vast immorality majority.
In general.
Just real quick, I would disagree with the vast majority of what you said right there. And so would G-Man. I think that's the real issue here. I think that's the position he's against. Now, as far as some of the other stuff, like, you know, the personal attacks or whatever, again, I haven't watched all his videos from start to finish, and if there were certain things out of pocket that I find that he shouldn't have done, then I will have to rebuke him as a brother on those things. But I think his ultimate position is just saying, if you're going to say it, whether you are celibate or not as a gay person, whether you're celibate or not, if you're going to say that other people doing those things, it's not against, you know, the Bible, or it's not against God's commands, then that's the disagreement.
Let me ask you a question, Antonio. Answer this honestly, if you can. Who exhibits the most Christian-like behavior between G-Man and Jade?
I'm in no position to say that because I'm not in either of their heads.
Then you're in no position to talk about homosexuality either.
So, on a side note.
Thanks.
So, on a side note, Antonio, have you spoken to Brother Faithful lately?
No, not in a while.
Okay, you should probably. You still have his number?
I'm pretty sure I can get in touch with him quite easily.
Okay, I would definitely give him a call after this hangout. not just for your edification, just for your knowledge. You should definitely get in contact with him. Because G-Man's been dropping his name too, and Faithful does not agree with him at all.
Yeah.
Well, if I find a reason to do that, well, I mean, that's between him and Faithful, but I don't know. I might think about it, but I really got to take off. I really appreciate you guys having me.
No problem.
All right. See you next week.
I'm hoping Antonio will actually find the Bible study that was done last week. It was a two-hour Bible study done on this topic, and it's always going.
Okay.
It was on the Shadow Heathens channel. A two-hour Bible study was done on the topic.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure meeting all of you guys, by the way. I know this is probably our first interaction. Sorry under the circumstances, but it was very nice meeting the guys that I haven't before, Fiona, Dragnaut, Cliff. Gary, I don't believe I heard anything from you, but nice to meet you, Gary.
You don't want to hear anything from him. Just I still have to clear out my Skype chat. You don't want to. No, don't add him to Skype either. Don't.
49 just... confirmed kills, guys. You don't want to talk to this guy.
Actually, many too, but.
You need help. You need professional help. You know that, right?
Yes.
Could I just point out that
where did Gary come from?
I don't know.
A dysfunctional family.
Gainesville.
Well,
Could I just say that I'm a Roman Catholic.
I'm sorry. I was just saying bad.
Shit. Okay. Oh yeah. Go ahead and let. Oh okay.
Yeah. I'm a Roman Catholic, and I don't know of any other Roman Catholics who are so virulently anti-homosexual as some of what I call the radical evangelical fundamentalists or extremists.
Yeah.
It surprises me. Well, I say surprises me. It shocked me when I came online and discovered that these people existed. Mm. And I think one of the reasons Jade has been targeted is not to do with her homosexuality, it's to do with her Roman Catholicism. Because these same people have attacked that again and again and again. And I think it is now, let's just find anything to attack these people because they don't agree with G-Man. And you see, the G in his name, I believe in his mind, stands for God. He's the God man. And if you do not agree with him, then you are not a Christian. Now, Antonio wasn't prepared to say anything about that, who seemed to be acting in the more Christian manner. It wasn't his place. If it is not his place to say who is behaving like a Christian, then it's certainly not G-Man's place to say who is a Christian. And G-Man's first comments on this topic were, Jade is not a Christian.
Yeah.
So if Antonio can't even work out who might be behaving in the better Christian manner, is he calling G-Man out for actually stating that Jade's not even a Christian. You bet he's not. Just like he probably won't call him out for that shouting nonsense.
No, he won't. Here's the thing. With Antonio, I like him when you get him away from G-Man. When you get him away from G-Man, you can talk to him. When he's in with G-Man, he has to act kind of big. And
he feeds like off of it.
Yeah. He won't say nothing bad about G-Man, but he will say he will condemn him, but he won't really say anything bad about him.
May I have your guys' permission to use a clip?
Yeah, go ahead.
From your hangout. It's going to be the shouty bit.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because I'll use the clip and I'll make a video.
Watch out for your headphones, Jade.
Yeah, and the reason being that actually dragged me away from Rachel Maddow. Ooh. Yeah. Now it usually takes wild horses to drag me away from that because I just love watching it. But I think maybe in a way I felt it was a slight responsibility because it happened in my hangout with the bullhorn. And I felt really bad for not hitting the mute button fast enough.
Same here.
And it also affected Dragonaut as well. I had two people in that hangout that were really badly affected by that.
And you know, I was watching from the outside at the time and I was affected by it, but not for my problem. More for, holy fuck, what's that doing to Jade? I had this. Jade is a very, very close friend of mine, and Drag as well. But I don't see Drag as suffering it to the same degree that I know that Jade does. And so, you know, it was my wanting to protect my friend kind of thing. I was really offended on behalf of my friend in a visceral way, shouting at the screen type way.
Why am I being presented?
I thought you were going to share the video. Sorry.
No. I was going to use a clip from yours to make a video.
No, go ahead.
If you don't mind.
No, I don't mind. Our stuff has always been able to. Anybody wants to use it for any kind of videos, our stuff has always been.
Thank you. I think this needs to be highlighted again.
Yeah. Especially how quick G-Man jetted out of the fucking hangout when Drag came in.
That was beautiful. Told you.
I have a little song for G-Man.
Oh, God damn it.
Who the fuck let Gary in?
I don't know. By the way, I'd like to say something. I know that some of the people who are watching this are also watching G-Man. And he has me blocked on my main channel, I believe. But if some of you would like to, could you go over there and in the comment section? I know Shani will probably delete them, but that's okay. Could you go over there and thank G-Man for the pain in my ears and my headache that I have right now? Just thank him for that for me, please, if you choose.
I can't do it. He's blocked me in all his channels.
Oh, I know. But I'm sure there are some people who might want to just, you know, let him know that, he's caused physical pain that's still lasting, and I now have a headache from that as well.
Yeah.
You know,
One other thing I'd like to just say, right? And I'm not trying to be preachy. Honestly, I'm not. But I'm going to go to John 3:16 again, okay? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but shall have everlasting life. Okay, let's go to the beginning of that. For God so loved the world. Not for God so loved the heterosexual world. Not for God so loved the evangelical world. It's not that either. It's not for God so loved the non-sinning world. It's not that either. It's the whole world. It's all of us. Every last one of us. That is what John 3:16 is telling you. That is the very crux of the crux, a good word for that, given the crucifixion, but that's the crux of the gospel message. Love, for God so loved the world. Not hate, not condemnation, love. He desires every single person to end up with him. And that's why he sent Christ as a safety net, because we do sin. We can't avoid it because it's part of being human. So we have a safety net now. That's what the gospel's about. It's not about going about condemning everybody. It's not going about calling people out on sins. We've got this sin supposedly of homosexuality that doesn't make it into the Ten Commandments. It doesn't make it into the seven deadly sins. And yet here we have somebody banging on and on and on and on about it while he exhibits the pride and the lying tongue and all. I don't know how many of the seven deadly exhibiting. And he's caught in something that Jesus didn't even bring up.
It's as if it's self-hatred.
But when you actually ask about that, he thinks that you can't, this not judge others means you can't judge them exact same sin. Yeah. Because when I brought that up with him, his response was, he actually thinks he's got to be guilty of the same for the passage about judge not lest you be judged accordingly applies to him. But that's not the way it should be interpreted. Because if we go to the woman taken in adultery, Christ said to the crowd that were ready to stone her, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. He didn't say, let he who is without the sin of adultery cast the first stone, did he? Any sin, it's let he who is without sin, let he who is sinless cast the first stone. And everybody walked away. They got it. They understood what he was saying. You've got your own sins. So put your own house in order before you go trying to fix someone else's house. And I'm finished. I'm sorry. I just had to get that out because this whole thing is making my blood boil.
I think the biggest thing that we all miss is that the man's functionally illiterate, so getting him to read and understand things is a task in and of itself.
Yeah.
Audacity.
Yeah, I didn't want to say anything earlier, but if you scroll all the way up to like one of the first things in the chat in here, his spelling of scholars was epic.
The spelling of scholars. We forgot to tell them about the G lexicon, didn't we?
Oh, good grief.
You guys don't know. We actually made an entire Wikia on G-Man sayings. I'll show it. Let me put it in the chat. There you go.
Is anyone going to nip that in the butt?
That's in there.
He's sticking to his gums. Don't watch it. You'll go to your elk.
I like how G-Man created the hangout and surrounded himself with enablers. That's interesting.
Yeah. Listen, guys.
You need some strepsils there, Gary.
Listen, can I say thank you very much for letting me in here? Thank you for letting me speak.
No problem.
And thank you for hopefully demonstrating that not all Christians are bubbling up with hatred.
Nah, we usually just kind of go after the ones kind of like G-Man.
You know, it's funny you should mention that, Fiona. G-Man idolizes the Bible. He uses it. He utilizes it as a weapon. I'm going to find the verse that will defeat those atheists or Christians that I don't like, or, well, not proper Christians, because, of course, he's full of the, you know, no true Scotsman fallacy with that regard. He idolizes the Bible. He is an idolater. You know, it is a tool. I don't, you know, as an atheist, when I read the Bible, the bits that stick out for me are the ones that, wait a second, that doesn't sound very, you know, I look at it with a skeptical point of view, an atheist point of view, and I'm sort of seeing the verses and catching the verses that, you know, say it's nonsense, basically. And of course, that's a reasonable thing to do. But G-Man uses his Bible to find the right verses. I don't think he actually looks at it in the spirit, with the Holy Spirit. He uses it, to use the Christian point of view, with the satanic spirit of how can I use this to attack other people? Not the, you know, love your enemies as you love yourself. Hate your enemies because I want them to burn. That's his attitude.
Yeah. And that's the sad thing about it.
Yeah.
But anyway, I'm going to go, guys. Thank you very much.
No problem. Okay.
Take care, peeps. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I do want to make note real quick. There's something that Nightbot threw up. Totally off subject, but Pitmonk's channel got flagged by a troll, and he's not able to stream for 3 months. The channel for his new backup channel is actually thrown up by Nightbot. If you guys enjoy Pitmonk, please go and check him out. So, sorry, go ahead. Whatever y'all want to say.
I would like to say, let's go to the shows, G-Man's
satanic wall
with his fucking system, okay? You can calm down, Brad.
I can't understand anything you say.
Yeah, I can't either. All I heard was calm down. That was it. God damn it, Gary.
That's anyway. A jailhouse Wi-Fi.
I think we're going to go ahead and end it here. I think this actually is probably about one of my favorite hangouts we have done in a while. Even with the whole G-Man craziness, I think at the end of it, this is probably my favorite. So, I want to thank everybody that's come on here. You guys were fucking awesome. Especially Kyle and especially Jade and it just Bionic Dance. Everybody that showed up here really kind of put the clown car posse down. So
it was fun. A tall feat, was it not?
and also with Brian being new, thank you for coming in. And no, you can't sing us out, Garrett. You know what? Get the fuck out.
Yeah, thanks for the invite.
I'm going to interject you just because I can. I know who you are, so.
Yeah. Gary Ridgway, famous serial killer.
Yeah, I'm going to get killed tonight. But, guys, thank you for coming on. It was a blast. Post-show will be in about 10 minutes. Give me time to set it up, and we will see you guys later.
All right. Nice meeting everyone. Thanks for the invite.
Later. I didn't get an invite. I got it off someone else, but I hope it was okay.
Joining, you know, it was totally fine. Like, you were good, so don't worry about it.
Yeah. So.